my money singing. Laughing at them haters like.
You're on the Virtual Entertainment Programming Network, TVEPN.com. TVEPN Studios, The Slam Show. And now, your host, Slam.
It's okay, Chris. You can do a selfie if you want. You don't have to be shy about it.
I saw Sage do it. I was like, I'm about to get one myself.
Right?
Oh, my
God. Sorry
goodness.
I didn't include you guys, but there's plenty of time later on in the show.
I know. Me and Jay don't got pictures together, so I'm like, exactly. Do a selfie here.
That sounded kind of weird, but all good.
Right?
Yeah. Welcome, everyone, to another edition of The Slam Show for July 21st, 2014. I am, as always, the main man, Slammin Sam. Sam. Was I going to say son?
Slammin Sam.
Slammin son. Where's your son at?
Yeah. That was that volunteer. Oh, this past Wednesday, I had a son temporarily for the evening.
Rent a son.
Exactly. Before I begin, I'd like to have my co-hosting staff introduce themselves.
I'm the lovely Lady Sage.
Cindy here.
Mike on the mic.
Joe Coz with Joe Time Entertainment. Hello.
Yes. And our special guest in the house.
Who's going first? Oh. Christylez.
Jason D.
They are from the Remix Crew Club Starters. Welcome, Woo! Gentlemen.
Thank you.
You guys came all the way down from the South Bay.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
We left extra early.
That's right. Because that traffic over here is freaking horrendous.
Ah, for real. I was going to take my motorcycle and have Jason ride in the back. But he didn't want to do any two-ups right here, so.
He doesn't want to do this?
Yeah. I told him sit in the front the other way.
Ooh, that sounds hot, though.
Wasn't that Kanye video?
Yeah, with Kim
Kardashian.
Yeah, the James Bond movie.
That, too.
Kim West.
Kim West.
I'm all Kim,
That's too much. But everyone out there, thank you for joining us for another edition. We have a lot on this episode to go over, talk about, especially later on when we do our interview with two of my favorite DJs here from the Bay Area that's holding it down like no other. Club Starters, you guys are the bomb.
Wow, you have favorite DJs.
I know.
Thank you, Sam, for having us on the show.
Yeah. So, like, fan crush going on?
Yeah.
As I was saying.
No homo.
Exactly. So, before I get into anything, let's go ahead and catch up on our past weekend haps, and we'll go ahead and start from Joe's end of the studio, because you won a competition. Let's have a big round of applause.
Joe Time.
Yeah, what kind of competition was it?
It was a stand-up comedy competition at the Oakland Continental Club on Saturday. Yeah, I mean, I went up second, ended up winning first.
Damn.
All right. Is there any prizes with that?
Yeah, it was cash prize, and then I get to go on the road with the headliner.
Oh, nice.
We'll be going to L.A. in 2 weeks.
Really?
So I'll be doing a few shows with him, so...
Are you going to still be able to make it to the show?
Yeah, I better not be on a Monday.
Yeah, I told them about the Monday situation.
Okay.
And then, so it should be a weekend, so should be back in time.
Good,
that's dedication,
good.
Man.
Yeah,
that's right.
Gotta make it happen.
Standard bit, or did you have added anything new to it?
No, I mean, it's competition, so when you do a competition, I mean, I've learned a few tricks of the trade while doing comedy for a while, and then I could just execute it accordingly. Release some secrets. I mean, honestly, and everything I did, I just, you know, had a great time on that stage. That was my main focus. I mean, I gave myself the permission to really just feel good then. And, you know, when I got up there, resetted the room. That's a secret for you guys.
Reset the room.
Yeah, you could actually follow anybody. You could follow Sinbad if you wanted to. You could follow anybody, especially in the DJ. I don't know if it works with DJ, but I'm thinking it could. What you do is you just reset the room, and then you just reintroduce yourself and just... play the game the way you want to play it.
Awesome.
Not try to match the last guy and not try to outdo the next guy.
Mm-hmm.
You just want to outdo your last bit.
Okay. Good. That's the formula.
Nice.
The winning formula. Right on. Once again, Joe, congratulations on
Thank
that.
You.
And in 2 weeks, you're going to be doing a show over at Tommy T's on a Wednesday, correct?
Wednesday, Woo. July 30th.
Yeah.
We'll be at Tommy T's. I'll be headlining that show.
We're going to be there to support.
Yeah, it's going
to
be an awesome show. We got an amazing lineup. Yeah, should be a flyer up very soon on my website.
What time does it start?
7:30.
Oh, shoot. We got to get there early, guys.
Yeah,
get
some
food.
I need that seat right up there.
Mm-hmm.
I'll get you guys a VIP section.
Which one? Pleasanton?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Pleasanton. 7:30, Joe Time Comedy Show. Just say Joe Time at the door, Joe Kors at the door. You're getting for $5. $5. I'm losing out on money, but it's all good. Don't worry about it.
That's awesome,
Enjoy
Joe.
Enjoy yourself.
Cool, cool. All right. Before we get into our next co-host, Haps, I want to kind of give a little introduction to this gentleman I met over at a party. He just approached me and said, Sam, I just want to be involved with what you got going with the Slam Show and so forth. I have experience working behind the mic over at Sacramento State. I did all these announcements for all these games. I said, you know what? Enough. You're invited. Come on the show. And he is now on here. Michael Smith, a.k.a. Mikey on the mic.
Yeah, Mike on the mic.
Mikey.
Yeah. And I was explaining to Cindy and Joe before the show, you know, I dibbled and dabbled in a little bit of everything from, you know, voiceover work to you know, play-by-play to acting, singing and rapping, a little bit of producing.
Adult films.
adult films.
With the monkey?
With the monkey. Oh. And,
tentacle porn.
Yeah.
All the works.
And,
oh, shit.
Joe might be convincing me to do a little comedy routine, too. And then speaking of the selfies, you know, this weekend, you know, my selfie failed. I got Slammin Sam perfectly. Met Slammin Sam out at the Uptown Lounge Friday night. He's like, hey, Mike, on the mic, let's get a selfie. Got him brilliantly. My face was completely out of it. So I'm still. I wouldn't even call myself a beginner. So I'm just not even a selfie.
So is that why it was never posted? Because I've never seen it.
Yeah, because he basically did the selfie for me, but he pushed and held everything with his own camera.
Yeah.
Oh,
wow.
It's got me only.
Yeah. My
can you believe that?
My angle's always been bad. Like that's what I'm still working on in my golf game too. Is just like finding that right angle because I think I'm like lined up and then it goes way right. So
you're like a fail among millennials.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I'm not that good.
Can't
that...
take a selfie.
No.
But isn't the camera facing you? I mean, what's so hard about it?
Well, no.
You got one of those old phones. Well, you got to flip around the other way.
Well,
like
how Chris did it right now.
Well, you can see it.
How Chris did it right now.
Well, it was dark and we needed to utilize
the flash
aspect.
Okay.
So, yeah. So that made things a little bit more trickier and difficult. But
I should have put that up on the show because it was like a perfect selfie of me with him not even in it, and he's like right onto me, like his head is right next to my ear, but yet it just caught me.
Creepy. So, there's someone gnawing on your ear.
Oh, snaps. But Mikey, thank you for being able to make it.
Hey, thank you for inviting me, man. I'm honored.
I'm excited.
Yeah.
See what you're able to bring to the table.
Sure.
All right.
Sure.
And looks like Cal Bear grew up on you.
Yeah, you know what? Cal Bear season ticket holder.
Nice.
Love the Cal Bears. And it was kind of a choice between, I was telling Joe, it was kind of just grabbing the next thing in line from my closet. Everything's kind of lined up and coordinated and
alphabetized.
Got to be matching,
not alphabetized,
right?
But yeah.
Got to match down to your kicks right there.
Everything's matching. And I asked my niece beforehand, I said, hey, are we going with the Colin Kaepernick jersey and the Niner fit, or are we doing the Cal thing today? And she said, let's go with Cal because that's Elsa color. So I said, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
You know, the niece always wins out.
Always.
Always.
Nice.
Yeah.
Cindy.
Well, let's see. This weekend, I did some work. Then I went to my sister's out in Stockton. And I think Stockton's kind of underrated because it is kind of janky out there. But there.
Did you hear about that crazy freaking gunfire?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. Whole big
car chase.
Robbery,
yeah.
Car
crazy
chase.
Enough. That was because I work at Safeway 3 blocks down from that on Pacific.
Oh,
and and our pumps just randomly shut off because I'm the fuel station manager for the gas station at that Safeway. And our pumps just randomly shut off because there was a lot of police activity. I mean, cars were going back and forth. And I was like, man, there's got to be something here. And come to find out, customers are coming in saying that it was blocked. You know, if you try to go northbound on Pacific, they're rerouting people to go back southwards.
Mm-hmm.
And then enough customers were telling me that actually one, her brother has a glass shop right on the kitty corner opposite of the Bank of the West and saw everything. And And it just so happens that that was a courtesy clerk at my store's mom. So,
wow.
Yeah, rest in peace, man. I mean, just goes to show, small world, man. It's a small world. That beat really hits all the time. But yeah, no, I mean, you know, and I wish the kid best of luck. I mean, he's just 19 years old, great kid, always has a good attitude for, you know, and courtesy clerk, you're kind of low man, a totem pole at a grocery store. So, but always has a good head on his shoulders. He just returned back from like a mission helping out in Europe with his church.
Oh, okay.
And, you know, I was there when he came into office and asked managers for some time off. And, you know, I hope that he takes his time off and kind of reflects on it. I mean, it's a tough way to kind of visualize your mom go out. But
Yeah, that's too bad.
So.
On a less shitty note.
Sorry about that.
No, that's cool. There's a little bakery shop there where we pretty much ordered a sampling of every possible. Like if you go to a wedding cake tasting, but you just want to be a fat ass and you're not getting married.
That's me.
Yeah, see, so we did that and we had the expensive champagne that I bought for my friend's wedding that we didn't end up drinking. And spent the day just like making food stops and watching tacky movies, and it was awesome. No shootings, thankfully.
Was there a favorite cake?
There's one called a princess cake, and it's like a white cake, and it has like a marzipan frosting and like cream filling, and it's fantastic.
And it's like 2,000 calories.
Yeah, probably just for like every fork bite is probably a couple thousand.
It's probably so worth it.
It is worth it. It's fantastic. And, you know, if, you know, dangers aside in Stockton, there's so many cool hole in the wall food places.
Agreed.
Burgers, bakeries, pizza, you know, everything you can think of. Tacos.
Adult clubs. Deja vu.
Yes. Yeah. Speaking of Stockton, I didn't do anything this weekend. Just lay low. Secret. But Sam and I went to Deja Vu on Tuesday.
That's right.
Yeah. How'd that go?
$2 Tuesdays. Yep. Hanging out with the Deja Vu crew.
Yep.
Oh, they're going to be here next month.
All right.
Yes, yes. The strippers
crew?
In the house.
Okay, strippers. Okay, yeah. I like the crew. I like the bouncers.
Yeah, they're like family to us.
Yeah.
Besides the strippers, it's always on, you know, rotating here in our show. But, you know, shout out to Reggie, Callie, Ray, and
Mikey
Montana. Yeah. Shout out to you guys.
Yes. So Deja Vu will be in the house next month here on the Slam Show.
All right.
Okay, gentlemen. Chris. Yes. Jace, how was your weekend?
Damn, weekend. Where do we start with the weekend?
Where do we start, Chris?
I don't know. Typical,
Besides the remixing,
schedule.
The producing, the studio work.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I was off for a couple of days, though. I mean, what you call it? Everybody probably knows on the social media I'm having a baby, so.
Oh, congratulations. Yay!
So, my wife had me on baby duty on cleaning and making her room. So, I was stuck cleaning and painting and doing all the fun work that probably an upcoming dad not so great
should
dream.
Be doing.
Assembling the crib, make sure it's safe.
Well, I mean, the crib not yet, because obviously those two guys that are watching us, Mike Alvin, shouts out. These guys are my best man. We're gonna have a build party, so we're gonna have like drinks and food and just try to build a crib. So that, normally a crib will take you like maybe like 2 hours.
It doesn't sound probably safe if you mix it with alcohol.
Well, not as long as you don't leave the alcohol in the crib. I think we'll probably be fine, but yeah, then. Gig, normal weekend.
We did go to Myth, though, to, you know, network with a couple peeps out there. Those guys. And we went Thursday. And then Friday, I DJed. Saturday, DJed, too. So it was just a normal, consistent weekend.
Yeah, Thursday through Saturday is pretty much our gig schedule. Yeah. I mean, like, then you got our, like, Monday through Thursday type daytime where we do all the remixing work and all the music stuff and all the club store to business stuff. So, I mean, schedule's
especially
full.
Especially for you, Chrissy. He's doing, like, how many stations are you doing right now? You're doing the Miami?
I'm doing two stations.
Florida.
One here in Cali, which is Cadon in Monterey, Central Coast. And then the other one's in Florida, WBTT, over in Fort Myers.
Awesome.
Oh, so, yeah. Get those. I mean, obviously, I'm pre-recorded a little bit in those mixes, so.
Really? But, I thought you were live.
My private jet going to Florida, you know, conked down because I couldn't afford the gas. You know, you have to go to some baby fund. But I do like pretty much like seven mixes a week, and then along with that, with the whole Club Stars thing. So I got my work cut out for me.
Keeping busy.
Hey, try to keep busy. I mean, you know, keep on the grind.
Yeah, you got to keep up with Jason.
You have to.
Well, yeah, I got to keep up with him.
It's my work. We're pretty much like on the phone. I mean, first thing, you know, I do wake up, know that I got to work on some edits and stuff. I'll call him. We'll talk about music, what's hot, you know, what's...
People still call each other? You didn't Skype or text?
I don't text them. I just call them. I'm just
dude, straight up.
There we go, man.
Like, he doesn't even like say like what's up to his girl first. He goes, I'm gonna call Chris right now.
We have the business phone too.
You guys
so the business
just
phone
live
we
together.
Do our,
oh yeah.
You know the intercom and you know we talk about music. We talk about you know what you know what's being played and what should we remix? What's hot? Of course with me too. I still you know I do the 99.7 on Saturdays and so we're just just getting prepped up for the weekend. That's our weekdays are pretty much.
I don't know. Weeks go by fast, man.
Yeah,
I mean,
they do.
It's like time. I was like by the time you know it's
already.
Oh,
it's
dude,
already like, yeah.
It's
Thursday.
Already freaking Thursday.
Like
when
Thursday
when we leave
like
tonight.
It's already August.
Most people, I see like they rant on Facebook, like, is it Friday yet?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's Friday for me every day.
Must be nice.
Monday yet.
You know, but I mean, you know, I try to rub it into like a bunch of friends who do 9-to-5s and stuff like that. But even the DJs who do 9-to-5s, I try to rub it in a little bit on them. You know, I mean, like, you know, just to get them on their type of like, you know, on their game a little bit. I just tell them, hey, if you guys are sick of your job, you just take a risk, man. Yeah. You know, I mean, me, Jason, like, you know, we don't live lavish or anything, but, you know, we all about taking risk.
No private jets?
No, not yet.
Not yet.
No, we had a carpool. He didn't want to drive alone. I said, dude, we should look good. Yeah. You know? Then he wanted the red carpet from Sam.
Yeah.
I don't think Sam.
That's one of our jokes.
That.
How we say we get the red carpet too, or something. I mean,
every club we go to, yeah, he always asks us for something crazy. Like,
yeah,
you guys have red carpets.
I'll give you the yellow brick road. How's that?
I know, right?
Oh, like even lights better. Up right that's when you actually... walk every single portion. Yeah. Yellow brick road.
Love how about the gray driveway?
Yeah.
Work. Yeah.
Oh, keep it simple, man.
Right on, gentlemen.
I'll roll it out just for you guys.
As far as
it's just our little thing that we always say, yeah. Red carpet, you know.
It's awesome. It's awesome. As far as my past weekend, I was over at before mentioned by Mikey there, uptown over in Brentwood, rocked it.
Yeah.
Over at Lift Lounge, Walnut Creek, same thing. And if you want more information on my next appearances, be sure to go to my Instagram at IamSlammin or Twitter, Facebook, and all that stuff, as well as all the TV EPN haps. All right. Let's go right into our past week's guests. That was Matt Abaya Bridger of the Vampiria movie effort that they're putting together. All I got to say is he needs to hurry up and get that movie finish because I'm so excited. If you guys didn't watch the replay of it, it was freaking funny.
How is he gonna get it finished when I haven't even had my cameo in it?
Our cameo.
I'm sorry, our cameo.
He promised the filmmaker of this movie. He said, "Sam, well, I'm gonna get everyone on a cameo. We're gonna make it happen, and don't you have no worries." So, Matt, we're waiting for that call because we want to get our cameos in. That's for sure. We want to be just like Mikey in the middle here.
Yeah.
Be in a film. That's
is there any monkeys in there?
We could ask them. A vampire monkeys.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
Better than monkeys. Oh,
what's up with the monkeys?
Gibby.
Oh, tell me later.
Yeah. Joe, how was the interview last week?
Oh, it was awesome, man. I mean, Mark, was it Mark, right?
Matt,
I'm sure I got Mark, mine.
That's an A. Start with him.
Yeah. We had Matt and...
Bridger.
Yeah, no, they're awesome. She was like a martial artist. She's like a skilled martial artist. She's an actor as well. And just her passion and what she does and how she presents herself is awesome. Like, she holds herself very well.
Mm-hmm.
And their relationship together is pretty awesome. Like, they're they only met for a while now. It's only been like almost a couple years or something.
Mm-hmm.
And the camaraderie is pretty awesome. And then for Matt, I mean, he's a really dedicated guy. When he has a focus and when he has a drive, he goes into it. Like, I'm sure you guys do the same thing when you guys are busting down your edits and really just breaking down your music. He does the same thing. He does his research on certain... he was talking about the movie itself had a lot of monsters.
Yeah, stuff that
mainstream monster movies don't have.
Mm-hmm.
And then he would go in deeper and find out certain ones, and then he would really find a way to portray that on this film. Yeah. So just trying to see the realism and what he was trying to portray, and looking forward to just seeing that, especially with his passion and his vision and who he is as a person.
Exactly. Because
should be awesome.
Check this out, Chris, because he had to actually go into Filipino lore and find all these creatures that, like the swang and stuff like that, stuff that only comes from our culture.
Oh, like straight up myth. But I mean, like, you know, something I never believed that, like.
Well, it's coming to life.
It's not a myth. It's true.
I know, but I mean...
Aswan.
Yeah, I mean, it's like...
I'm an Aswan, no, like, you just don't know it.
It's just like, you know, when you get, you know, I was born here, so like your parents and your cousins would tell, yeah, man, we got some crazy half-legged people there. I was like, what? Really? So, you know, my first time in the Philippines was in 2009, and I was hoping to see that. But I never got to run into it. But I was just like, you know, I was like, oh, am I going to run into something crazy? But it's just like, you know, but I was like, it wasn't that bad. I was like freaking out for a minute. I thought I was going to see like some vampire with two like...
Penises?
Yeah. I don't know where that came from. Yeah, sure.
What is that?
Oh, yeah,
well, since you haven't seen, we would definitely see it in this movie. So.
Oh, okay.
Wow. Yep. Cindy.
Yeah, I asked him about his research, and he was just—he was very into breaking away from any kind of traditional horror movies that we've just gotten so used to. Because there's so many vampire movies, there's so many zombie stories, and so many virus outbreaks, and you know, it's time for something a little different that people haven't seen before. And I wouldn't be surprised if things like that kind of caught on, if people, you know, kind of branched out to other areas of folklore and horror, because you know, there's not that much new under the sun coming out. So it'll be really interesting to see how he puts this story
together.
Yeah,
it's been a while since I've seen anything like some of those type of things, like from the '80s, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. I was like, all the horror, like, I guess they go in cycles or something.
Yeah, they do. You're right. They do. Like, vampires will be really hot for a while. Yeah. Zombies are kind of dying off now that, like, you know, Walking Dead has been on a break till October. And then, you know, what's going to be cool next? What's interesting? And what can we make with special effects that's not hokey, that's still going to be scary to people? And should be interesting to see what comes out.
Exactly. Sage?
I totally agree with Cindy. I mean, with this, you know, Filipino folklore, it's... within his background, it's going to be awesome. And with the trailer that we watched, we saw a lot of hot girls in there, so I'm kind of excited.
Wait, hot girl?
Yeah.
There's pretty girls in this movie.
Come on, Jason, wake up. Just said hot girls, man.
Hot girls.
Hot girls. Oh, man. I'm sorry, let me rephrase that. Hot vampires.
Okay.
There you go.
Is it okay?
Okay. My wife's probably watching this right now. She's like, all right, what's she talking about? Some vampires. Now he has a fetish with vampires.
Oh,
great. When I get home, she's going to be in costume, though. She'll be like, hey, you know, I heard you.
That's going to be a weird looking one. Pregnant and a vampire? I don't know.
Hey, if you could think of it, somebody's into it. That's the rule.
I don't think she has that much of a fetish, though. I mean,
to that point. You never know.
You
never know.
She's coming out of the closet when I get home. All right, dude, we're not going back. We're staying there.
we're gonna have a cot out here in the studio for you.
Straight up.
And just to add to that, I'm not a True Blood fan, so I'm more of where there's a lot of special effects and
you're
know,
into
like
the CGI
horror
thing.
Yes, yeah. Type of horror movies, not no True Blood or whatever. Really? I don't go for that.
Are you a True Blood fan?
Nah, honestly, like people be telling me, "Hey, you watching this True Blood?" I was like, "What is this, man?
I've never seen."
I just started getting on this Walking Dead thing.
Like, how about Game of Thrones?
See that too. People are like, "You like porn? Watch Game of Thrones." Like, what?
And I'm worse. I don't even watch TV. I hardly even. The only time I watch TV is like probably the news, and that's it. I really don't. I'm not.
You watch
my
the fiance, news?
The worst
kind of TV. I know.
My girl, she's all into that stuff.
So you get your info from her.
Yeah, she kind of. I'm like, "What are you watching?" I'm watching this show. It's something new, and I'm like, all right.
Yeah, I couldn't get down to those.
For me, I'm not really. I don't get into those shows. I'm just like, okay.
Don't get into it, man. It's just a bunch of garbage and shit out there.
No, it'll suck you in and waste so much time. Yeah. I hate getting hooked on a TV show.
But you can remix a little bit of what they got in there. Probably.
That's true. Yeah. Get your creative juices going.
They got some better orgasm sounds than.
Speaking of shows, I just want to throw this in. There's actually a show on TLC, or is it TLC or VH1 called Dating Naked.
Never heard of it. Seen that one. Yeah. I think I've seen
and
that.
That's what I just do anyways.
Yeah. I'm like,
that's not
oh, why not?
This is unattractive. It's really unattractive. You see a girl with, you know, it's unattractive.
And it's blurred, too,
yeah, and
right?
It's blurred, but not her
pooch. Well, it's VH1. I hope it's blurred.
I think so. Yeah, I think it's VH1.
I don't know. I think some of these shows are getting, like, way over, like, I don't even think they make them like they used to. There used to be like fun shows back in the day.
Well, reality sells now, man.
Yeah, but
reality
really
sells.
Naked people. Like,
that's
really
not really reality.
Unattractive naked people.
Yeah, see, what I don't, that to me,
hey,
I wouldn't
but you
watch
know what?
That
I'd be
crap.
Funny, but I don't think of it crazy.
I wouldn't watch
I'm not
it.
Trying to look at
waste
the girl's
my time
tits
on the
or
shows.
Anything. I mean, it's blurred.
I would not waste
I get
my
more
time.
On the internet than I even get watching VH1.
Naked's in, though. My mom and dad, they watch those, like, home.
Oh, wait, what? He just said, TLC. That just sounded wrong a little
yes,
bit.
That's another
and there's
one.
A buying said, naked, too.
Yes.
Like, naked,
yes.
I just heard naked and mom and dad. I'm like,
no, there's, there are actual communities set up here in the United States where. Everyone lives
community.
In a yeah nudist
oh, yeah,
community.
Yeah, nudist community.
And,
mm-hmm. You can go camping with think, them or yeah. whatever. Yeah.
I think Chris is, gonna go get the whole collection. Now. Look at him.
I'm a
like,
DVD I'm set.
Hey, dude, he's dude, like thinking too much. He's like,
I think about to purchase a house out there. Let's get escrow going.
There you go.
It was funny because this one guy was all about it, and then this one girl, she's just like, I can't do that. There's no.
Well, she was already naked. She's I can't do it.
Yeah,
I can't do it.
She's just like,
but she's already naked. What the hell?
Yeah, I don't know.
That's
it's
too
not,
much.
It's not for everybody.
Yeah. I'm actually guilty. I've like channel surf and seen that. Shame on me. Yeah. Oh,
there you go. Maybe we should convert one of the episodes to the Naked Slam Show.
I'm good. Not happening here. I'd be like.
Can we make it when the Deja Vu crew comes?
Why not? Why not? There you go. Kidding. There you go.
I'm not. Kinda.
He actually called you, but you didn't respond on Tuesday.
Called
so you,
me.
You asked that. Oh, he called you.
What, for a naked show?
I don't know, for Deja Vu.
Oh, Sam. Hey, we
me
will.
Me and Jason are about to put the front door.
Hey, we will make another trip out there for sure.
Okay.
All right. And to watch that episode with Matabaya and Bridger for the Vampiria filmmaker episode and other episodes, go to theslamshow.com or theslamshow.tv. All right, guys, we're going to go ahead and take a quick commercial break and be back with our sports and news topics here on The Slam Show. Hang tight.
Need cash now? Call 1-800-CAR-TITLE to borrow $2,500 to $50,000 against the value of your vehicle. 1-800-CAR-TITLE has been offering the lowest rates and monthly payments for over 10 years. Mention promo code FREEWAY to receive free gas with your loan. 1-800-227-8485. 1-800-CAR-TITLE, a proud supporter of the Freeway Series.
1-800-CAR-TITLE, fast cash and low payments every day.
It's hurricane and wildfire season again. Why do thousands of people sit in these reoccurring problem areas year after year, betting their lives that the disaster won't get them? Hundreds of you helped eFoods Direct ship 50,000 donated meals to the Oklahoma victims. The problem is we can't help everybody. If every one of us who can will take care of ourselves, we can all pitch in to take care of those who really can't. The new Just In Case pack from eFoods Direct is the big brother to the 7-day emergency pack designed for Oklahoma disaster donations. It contains a 2-month supply for one person, or a 1-month supply for two adults, or a 2-week supply for a family of four. The $320 price is $50 less than retail. Call 800-409-5633 on the web eFoodsDirect.com/Alex. Order two or more, get 10% off, free shipping applies. Call 800-409-5633 on the web eFoodsDirect.com/Alex.
Protecting your home with a security system is a must. But when it comes to protecting your family, your home, and belongings, there's no need to sign a long-term contract. Listen, there is some real scum in the alarm business, cashing in by locking you into long, punishing contracts. Not with Simply Safe Home Security. They're the good guys. You can trust Simply Safe to protect your family. Simply Safe was created by a Harvard Business School engineer, and it's revolutionary. You'll get 24-hour protection for just $14.99 a month. There are no hidden fees and no contracts. You'll save thousands. Plus, you're protected by their 100% money-back guarantee. Protect yourself against home invasions and break-ins. Order your Simply Safe system now and receive a wireless keychain remote, a $25 gift, free. So don't waste your time dealing with scum. Visit GetSimplySafe.com. GetSimplySafe.com. GetSimplySafe.com.
Introducing Pro One. All of your filtration in one system, portable, on the go. No more do you have two or three filters to just reduce sodium fluoride. You have a system that cuts out the sodium fluoride and up to 95% of hydrofluorosilicic acid. Advanced manufacturing technology combines silver impregnated white ceramic with new Aquametics advanced media for removal of fluoride and other heavy metals, all in one filter element. It is the only one that does it, and out of the gates, we have it discounted at 10% off with promo code WATER. This is the only system that in one unit helps reduce or remove pesticides, herbicides, chloramines, ammonia, and chlorine, hydrofluorosilicic acid, the most common form of fluoride not covered by other fluoride filter brands, and sodium hexafluorosilicate. Get your Pro Pure with the new Pro One filter today at InfoWarsStore.com or by calling 888-253-3139.
Taking a family of five to the amusement park can cost a small fortune.
Oh, yeah. So to save some money, we thought, hey, let's bring the amusement park to us. Yeah. Go ahead.
All right. Step right up, young man. Are you ready to ride the Wacky Waterfall?
That's just the bathtub with the shower head running.
Nope, it's the Wacky Waterfall.
It's a shower, Dad.
Waterfall.
Wacky.
There's an easier way to save. To get a free rate quote, go to geico.com. Then buy online, over the phone, or at your local Geico office.
You know the U.S. dollar is devaluing. You can see it happening every day. You know a new currency will take over at some point. Wouldn't you like to be in on the ground floor? Bitcoins. They're a decentralized, anonymous internet currency. They're free to use, free to accept, and free from inflation forever. You can use them anywhere in the world, and their value seems only to be increasing. Find out more at weusecoins.org. Don't be kicking yourself in the pants in a month. Your dollars are going down. Bitcoins are going up. Weusecoins.org.
Snoring. It's not just something to laugh about. Snoring could be a symptom of sleep apnea, a serious condition where breathing stops during sleep, and if left untreated, can lead to daytime drowsiness while driving, high blood pressure, acid reflux, heart attack, and stroke. Plus, the family issues of the snoring keeping others up all night. The first step in treatment is a sleep study. Through homeapneatest.com, it can now be done in your own home in the comfort of your own bed through the direction of a board-certified sleep medicine physician in your area. The test simply monitors your breathing while you sleep. For more information about sleep apnea, go to homeapneatest.com or call 1-877-54-APNEA. 1-877-542-7632.
If you're suffering from chronic pain, migraine headaches, or any other health issues, it might be your back telling you it's time for an adjustment. Come check out the new Health Chiropractic Center in Concord. We restore the curvatures of the spine to bring you back to good health and wellness. Our specialists will provide a full examination and x-rays for free. Just mention the Slam Show. Call now for an appointment at 925-759-9722 or online at thenewhealthcc.com. In order to transform your health, you have to try something new. The New Health Chiropractic Center.
Welcome back to the Slam Show. This is the sports and news segment sponsored by Kinders and Martinez.
Ooh, hooked us up with famous ball tip sandwiches and a rack of ribs.
So good.
Thank you, Kinders.
You can see the food porn on my Instagram.
That's right. And what is your Instagram?
It is underscore captain underscore underscore fantastic underscore.
Wow. There's a lot of underscores.
That's because I just had to have that name.
That's right. When you got to have that name, you got to do everything possible to sustain it.
There you go.
That's for sure. All right, let's go ahead and kick off this segment, and let's move to the first topic. And this past week, we had the 2014 ESPY Awards, which is basically the MTV Music Awards for the sports world. And just for presenting or even hanging out, I don't know. I don't know specifically, but they were giving away $23,000 value gift bags for all people involved in the program. And I actually took the liberty to print out some lists for our guests and co-hosts to review. And it is quite a lengthy item list of stuff. Oh, I gotta work harder on this, guys, because we need to freaking get to these shows so we could get these freaking bags. And it's not like a little kind of tote bag that you carry. It's actually like a luggage bag with all these items in it that could fit besides the gift certificate stuff and the stuff you have to actually go and presently use. So let's go right down the list. I want everyone's opinion on what was the coolest item, product, certificate.
Breathalyzer. I caught it first before everybody.
We're
going
to get to you, Chris. That's for sure. We're going to start off with Joe. Dude, can you believe this? This is all what you get for just being there.
Man, I don't even know half these products on here. That's how amazing they are. I know it's a luxury under $23,000. honestly, there's a few things, like he was saying, the BAC track, the blood alcohol content.
Right. There you go. Let me check that off because it's going down the list.
It hits close to home, man. I mean, athletes out there need it. Boy, Alden Smith back in jail doing his thing. I mean, come on, bro. I mean, it happens to the best of them. But at the same time, there's some other stuff, too. There's one, if I was a kid, I mean, still, I play with it. They got a Nerf gift certificate for over hundreds of dollars of Nerf equipment. And I'm pretty sure it's not a $10 gift certificate for Nerf guns.
Your Nerf guns are like bank. Like my nephew buys those things. I was like,
they're like 30, 40 bucks.
50
now.
Bucks?
And then all the accessories.
No kid has 50 bucks. Yeah. I mean, they got parents that'll pay for it, but it's like, wow.
Yeah, I'm a big kid, man. I like that Nerf stuff, bro.
Who doesn't?
I like the whistling footballs and stuff, launching it with the homies back in the day. We was just. There you go.
So basically, the breathalyzer stands out.
The breathalyzer and Nerf balls.
Nerf balls. Okay. All right. Mikey.
Now, something I was reading on the Nerf thing was that it only came with three darts, though. It was the Mega Blaster gun only came with three darts. So you got to pay 50 for the gun, then like an extra 25 for extra
that's
ammo.
That's where they get you.
Yeah, that's where
they
get you.
On the accessories, man. Yeah. I mean, then you want a laser pointer with that? What was the kid need a laser pointer for? What are they going to aim for? I mean, it looks good. What, did I blind you?
Yeah. But also running down the list, and I actually watched a little video that DeSean Jackson was kind of modeling everything. Mm-hmm. And they were a bunch of kind of, it seemed like they were really high-priced luxury kind of places that we've just never heard of that are not, that, you know, that kind of only for the elite, that only the elite would know about.
Yeah.
One of the things I liked that kind of resonated with me was the Kohler Moxie showerhead and wireless speaker, because I'm always wanting
too.
To like put my phone, you know, near me when I'm in the shower, but I don't want to damage it and get it wet. And now it's just like, you don't have to worry about that, man. It just pours out through the, as the water's pouring, the sound's pouring.
Which one is that called?
The Moxie waterhead shower speaker.
That sounds
Kohler.
Nice.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Selfies in the shower. There it is.
Make sure you do it right.
I would say that.
Up here,
Sam,
not down.
Sam will be behind
here.
You in the shower.
Up here, not down here.
Right. Or the TiVo Romeo, too, is a pretty cool gift, because they always talk about that on KMBR. Dwayne Kuiper for the Giants.
That's
says
right.
How he can record up to 5 shows at one time, and he loves his TiVo Romeo. So
there you go.
There you go.
Yeah, that's priceless right there. Cindy?
Couple of things that stood out besides that shower thing.
There's
a gift certificate on here for sailing lessons.
I just saw that.
There's a couple of resort vacations.
Yeah, that in itself is a high dollar thing.
Well, this
right?
Sailing's like sex to rich people.
Oh yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Are you talking about the Maui one, the Maui resort?
What is it? It's up here somewhere.
It's a pretty extensive list, ladies.
Yeah,
and
I'm like,
where everyone's into it. I knew this was going to be a cool
dinner,
thing to print out.
Steak dinner and wine bar.
I saw that just now.
Is that the Fleming's one?
You say steak?
Yeah.
Steak.
It's a steak.
Yeah, I'm just thinking of the things that like, pretty much everybody could use, because, I mean, there's stuff on here like ties and pet stuff and, you
just,
know,
just abundance of goodies.
Yeah, just things that are really cool, but it's like, I don't even live in that universe.
But I'd give these out to the women I'm messing with.
Oh, yeah.
We're going on a date tomorrow. We're going to a fancy steak dinner.
You know, there's an 18-inch and a 22-inch massager.
I said, fuck all you guys' pick, because mine is the
Let's go to you, Sage.
The Tiger Tail Classic 18-inch Tiger Tail Rolling Massager. Muscle massager plus a gift certificate for the long one, 22-inch.
That's what I'm 22
inches. You hear that, Jim?
Jason likes 22 inches.
Longer, right?
I might get that for him.
That's 3 feet, you know?
He can handle it.
No, joking aside, which one did it? What was my other pick? Because that one was kind of scary.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, we're just trying to pick apart the SB's gift bag.
Was it the vacuum?
No.
The dirt devil.
God, it was one for the casino where they name a cocktail after
you. Oh, yeah, I just seen that. Foxworth.
Damn it.
Foxworth, yeah, that one.
Foxworth.
Damn it.
Sage, what would be in the cocktail named after you?
Well, obviously it's going to be Sage. It's going to be like, what's in it?
Instead of mint leaves, would it have sage leaves in there?
Yes.
Hey,
like a
cellar.
Like a
right
mojito
there.
Style, but, right. You know, okay. Instead of the mint leaves, sage leaves. And, yeah. Something I'll make it just smile the whole night.
There's a few bars in San Francisco where you can order a Cindy Rezzo, which is a shot of Fernet and a punch in the face.
I love it.
I'll take the, yeah, I don't want the punch in the face, but I'll take the Fernet any day.
Cool. Jason.
I think the whole, like, breathalyzer is pretty cool. Like, I mean, with that, just...
Every Tuesday,
yeah,
like, saying
that. Sorry, I'm looking down the list, and, I mean, yeah, everything's cool. Like, Crunch Fitness, one-year gym membership.
Yeah, but, Mr. I mean, Swall over here.
I missed that.
Get the spa, dude, while you're at it, dude, after you work out.
Nah, but I got to say that breathalyzer is, you know, I know he brought it up, but that's pretty...
Useful.
Are you sure, sure you don't want the massager?
Especially in the industry.
3 feet all helping you.
I'll leave that for Chris.
18 Chris and 22 inches. You know, you put that together.
22s. We're not talking rims either.
Yeah.
Chris, rolling on to you.
I look at this whole entire list, yeah, like stuff that you probably wouldn't buy. Like straight up, like you wouldn't mind getting free. Like, it's like stuff like, you know, like, would you pay for
a luxurious chocolate bar?
Yeah. Or a piggy bank?
A dirt devil.
Or, you know, or some PX90? People would be embarrassed to buy PX90, but if you get it for free, damn right, I'm using that tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I mean, yeah, I mean, I was obsessed with the breathalyzer because all guys would say that's because anything electronics, I think. Yeah. You know,
any,
like,
gadgets.
Yeah, any type of gadgets, right? I mean, 22 Agreed. Inches up yours. Yeah, I mean, anything. You know? You know, however way
Wait,
you
my
like
question
it.
Is this just for the people receiving the awards or everyone?
Presenters.
That,
even the presenters.
And
the
nominees,
yeah.
I think.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. Well, it doesn't even pertain so to not people the that are... People that pertain, does it pertain to people in the audience?
Yeah, that's
no,
a good
it's
question.
Not Oprah.
Yeah, that's a bit much.
Oh, that's 23 G's each person.
But I guarantee, like,
I highly doubt it.
Like half the front row, that's part of the whole audience, is the presenters because they go up and then they sit back down.
Those
and so
people
forth.
Don't need any more money or shit. Right. So why should you give it to them?
Exactly.
Endorsing.
It's
so
too much.
They paid all that money for free seat for 23 G's. So they must have just gave 23 G's.
Essentially. But check this out, guys. On my behalf, if I got a freaking gift bag with this amount, boy, I am set for all sorts of Christmases coming up because half the stuff I probably will not use and possibly sell on Craigslist. But you're just set. You're good.
And it's funny that you bring Christmas up because one of the items that spoke to me when I first looked at the list, my parents, they've been hosting Christmas now with my dad's side of family, which is pretty large, about 40 people. For the last 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
And
we got to go there.
And my mom and dad are always trying to reinvent, like, you know, like the funness about Christmas, you know, making us feel like little kids, having like special toys, or like my dad has a certain like light up wheel that they had in the 50s with aluminum trees and stuff, just like really cool nostalgic stuff. And my mom and dad almost bought a soda stream last year so that we could all make our own flavored sodas and everything with I know they're pretty big if you go to like Macy's cookware section or something.
Mm-hmm.
And they almost pulled the trigger on it, but they got the snow cone machine instead. And
good call on that.
Yeah.
And soda's bad for you,
right? So but
let's put the syrup on ice instead of carbonated water, and that's much better for you.
But it's just cool, like, to make your own soda instead of just cracking open up a can and or, you know, pouring a liter into a glass, you know, to make your own soda. You're like, I made this, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it's pretty cool that they get the opportunity to get their own soda stream maker and then, what, $100 to use towards any of the syrups and everything. So
would you breathalyze all your family members coming out of your house with your breathalyzer? Too much eggnog for you, buddy.
Yeah, right? You're not going anywhere.
Yeah. That's
You're
too much.
You're going to get slapped with this massager.
It's 22 inches right 22. Off.
Exactly. So to cap off this whole topic, yeah, you are one lucky motherfucker to be attending and presenting over at the ESPYs. And like I said, guys, I'm going to do my fucking best to get us on that program just to go to where they're giving away the freaking gift bags.
Hell yeah.
And just to recall, a few Comic Cons ago, Sage and I went over to San Diego for the event.
That place.
And we actually missed the opportunity to be part of a event that we're giving away, like...
It was a Warner Brothers.
Yeah, Warner Brothers presentation. And they had gift bags there. And what I heard, what was it, like Rolexes or something like
what?
That? Yeah. That were in these bags, and we were like, where the fuck is this place? And we're just like searching.
Wait, this
down
is Comic Con.
This is at Comic Con.
Not inside Comic Con. It was the after party at the Marriott.
Yeah, next door.
And
yeah.
I think it was where Stanley was hosting it.
Correct.
Also, yeah.
Correct. So, yeah. They were bringing up the gift bag totals there.
This is the ESPYs. Yeah. You don't see no Rolex in here?
Yeah.
I mean, Comic-Con, ESPYs, right? I mean, you would think you would see a Rolex in here.
You
I
would. This. You
there
would,
Swiss
Chris.
Watches in there, but I don't think they're Rolex.
Once again, Jason D's your hookup on this, though, because if he ultimately gets that Small World beat out to Disney, Disney owns ESPN, that's
Amen.
Where we're in.
Amen. Amen.
Get on the work, man.
You're on it. Yes. You're on
well,
it.
Well, you motherfuckers need to find a DJ gig over there, and I don't know which one of you guys, but I'm rooting for Slam. Sorry.
All right. Moving on to our next topic. Check this out. And this is a topic that Cindy brought up to my attention. And it's pretty interesting, and we have some updates, so that's why it's a good topic to discuss. Back in April, rapper Andre Johnson, no, not the wide receiver from the Texans, he's actually affiliated with the Wu-Tang Clan.
Wu-Tang.
Back then, he severed his penis and leaped from a second-level building in North Hollywood. All right. Crazy, crazy. Obviously, we already know the story with that. Last week, he went on and set the record straight, claiming, yes, he was under the influence of drugs, but was in complete control. All right. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. That's
complete control
better.
After cutting your penis? Really?
Apparently.
Wait, jumping out of the building or the Ooh. Pool? What?
Jumping out of a second-level building.
Okay.
Now, during this high period, he realized that the root of his problems was because of his penis. So that's the reason of the whole cutting off thing. Now, part of his reasoning is that he could be closer to God if he didn't have this evil attached to him. And here's some bad news. They weren't able to reattach his penis.
Why? Because they couldn't find it?
I guess it was
and
just
put it on
long.
Ice?
Well, he deserves not to get reattached anyways if he cut off the first time.
Yeah, now, exactly.
Now, check this out. Before everyone gets to chime in, I want to add on to this. This isn't something new, guys, because if you watch Ancient Aliens, which I know majority of you guys do, there are descriptions of the Mayan culture being so connected to the upper powers that they would actually take drugs and herbs to influence them to
ayahuasca
to yes mutilate themselves and also cut off their genitals. So what Mr. Johnson has done is replicating is cutting perfect.
There it is.
It connects because he's just connecting with the whole Mayan effort here. So let's start with Joe. Is he going to be God by cutting off his dick?
What kind of question?
You say dick? He's like, you say dick?
Yes.
I said dick.
Is it a yes or no question?
Partially, but more opinionated.
You know, I mean, from what he was explaining, and I know it gets distorted through so many mediums, and I wasn't there.
I surely hope not.
From the result of what his actions were, obviously the ramifications were pretty big or small, depending on his
literally.
But what I'm getting at is, if he believe it's his body, that's one thing. It's his belief, that's another. Whether I believe or think that he's God or not after the fact, that's irrelevant to me. I could care less about that. But in his actions and him doing what he did and him coming out and saying those things and, you know, in a way where he could be criticized for the rest of his life. If he could deal with that, that's fine. But
it made the news.
It makes sense in a sense where he was saying that, you know, he did it because of his thing. But there's other ways of going about it. You know, there's rehab. I think Tiger Woods went to that one, the Sex Anonymous rehab. Probably go to a surgeon. But it was probably just impulse. He went off his, you know, what he thought was happening. And I don't, what kind of fucking, what did he use? Did he use a house knife? Like a
butter
cut
knife?
Toe, a little cut toe?
Butter knife. Cleaver.
Oh, no.
He used a cleaver.
One shot deal.
He told
that's
a monkey
like,
to cut it.
It's a Japanese shit.
I'd rather have it done swift, man. Screw with the.
I can't think about it.
Chris is already getting some ideas.
But he jumped out of the window.
It could be my belief one time. Watch out, man.
Mikey.
You're scaring me, Chris.
It's crazy.
Same question? Or
What do you think about this whole thing?
I don't know. It's kind of weird. Like, the first thing that kind of jumped into my mind, I don't know if you guys ever watched the show Workaholics.
Yeah.
Pretty funny show. And in this latest season, there was an episode where Blake, because throughout the whole show, it's been rumored that, you know, he has a small one, right? Because he's never getting any of the girls or anything. And so they're drug dealer friend Carl has or is made to have a pretty big Johnson. And so so there was a point in time where Carl was just like, you know what, I'm sick of having this dong. You know, there's too much responsibility with power. You know, with all this power comes all this responsibility. And I just don't want it anymore. And Blake's like, dude, will you hook your best friend up with your junk? And he's like, I would gladly do it. And he's like, but you can't wash it. He's like, but I gotta wash it. And he's like, well, if you don't, then, you know, it's not gonna go through. And so, I mean, they almost got to the point. I mean, Carl's going in for surgery. He's about to get it done by a doctor. And then at the end, you know, they kind of convince him, yeah, don't do it, don't do it. And he kind of pulls out in the end, and Blake just says, you know.
I was like, here we go. Where's the punchline on that one?
Blake says he's just happy with what God gave him in the first place.
I think I'm a fan of that show now. I got to start watching
it. Oh, you've
got to. It's really funny. These guys went to my high school, and it's like really bizarre just like seeing them on TV now.
What? Yeah, Blake's from Pleasanton, correct?
Concord.
Concord.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, they have a new show now.
Yeah.
Spinoff.
Yeah, it's pretty funny. But that's what first came to my mind. And I guess kind of like Joe said, I mean, if he has a certain belief on why he should get rid of it, more power to him. You know, I don't think he's God by doing it, but yeah, I would never do it.
That's good to know.
Yeah.
Cindy.
For a $23,000 gift bag,
would you cut your penis?
In all fairness, if we're going to go the philosophical or religious route about this, I mean, if he really wanted to get closer to God, he's snubbing God. God gave him a body that he polluted with drugs, that he threw out a window, and that he mutilated with a knife. You know, that's saying screw you to God. Here's this healthy body you have. You had a music career. You have the money to go around and buy drugs and do whatever, and you're polluting yourself and ruining yourself. So I think that takes him away from God. If you want to get into that philosophical,
that's fucking deep, Cindy.
I was just about to say deep. That's really profound.
Right?
Well, got me thinking for a minute there.
That's incredibly arrogant and selfish, and you know it got him media attention. That's a very shallow way to, you know, elevate yourself. You know, who are you to say you're
He
God
got caught cheating and didn't know how to deal with it.
Right.
See what it comes down
exactly.
To.
It's like you're selfish and shallow, and now you're making yourself famous for doing stupid
Now he's really
things.
Shallow.
Yeah,
he's
exactly.
Missing all of it.
Literally.
No, that's just a bunch of horse shit. Seriously, don't cut your penis off and say that you're a god. Come on. If somebody that wasn't famous did that, they would be, you know, they'd go to jail or, you know, protective mental hospital. And, you know, they don't get a TV interview and fame out of it because that's stupid.
And being spoken of here on the Slam Show.
Yeah, exactly.
Incredible.
Yeah.
Sage, top that.
My God, this guy's a fucking moron. He's on drugs. Enough said. I mean, if you're on drugs, you're not thinking clarity. Someone probably dared him to do it and is like, oh, yeah, that sounds so good right now. I'll do it. It has nothing to do with being closer to God, because if you are, you wouldn't be on drugs. You do it in an operating room, whatever. I don't know. Whatever. I mean, I'm thinking it's leisure drugs, not no prescription drugs, but either or. I mean, he shouldn't be on drugs to be doing something like that.
I mean, I've taken shrooms, and I've seen the world more clear than I've ever seen in my life before. For real. I mean, there's things that I've...
Well,
like,
maybe next time you might cut it off.
I'm saying is, like, drugs have a bad rap, but it depends on why you use it. It just depends on what it is.
Maybe it's just overabundance that he just got all crazy, you know?
Yeah, they probably laced it.
Well, clearly in this context, they're not a good thing.
Like smoking weed, that's not a drug.
That should be a drug education moment for kids. Like, you know, look at this guy. He had everything.
Imagine a kid looking at that. Oh, damn, he just put his dick off.
Right?
I don't want that. I'm not doing drugs.
Public service announcement. Watch this guy.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, now the question becomes, did he jump off the building to purposely harm his penis? Because then if he just jumped off the building just on drugs, like, look at me, I'm jumping off this building, and then maybe something bad happened, you know, he's going to urinate or have sex, and he's realizing that there's something wrong, he says, okay, now I've got to cut it off from when I jumped off, or did he?
Oh yeah, that's a great idea.
Like, what if he bent it in two places or something? I mean, or broke it in two places.
Oh, I don't know. What a silly thing to go to the hospital. You know, like
I wouldn't even want to know.
It's gonna be like left.
I'm just curious about the shroom things. I never took shrooms in my life.
Just any other conversation.
Club starters.
I was like, oh, I thought we were back.
Go ahead and close out this topic.
I don't know. I think. I think Dick's a very sensitive situation with Jason here. Going with 22.
Sounds retarded. I mean, he must have been on some real good stuff to like really go off to do that. I mean, it's just.
Well, you know, I mean, it's what if that? I mean, like everyone says, belief. I mean, you know, I mean, who are we to judge? I mean, I'm not trying to defend on him. Like, I think it's ridiculous.
I think you are.
Dick off,
I think Chris is.
But no, I mean, look at it another way. Like, so
you did mention how you would do it, right? Earlier.
But I'm just saying, like,
we all had a preference of how to cut your genitals
exactly.
off. You know,
fast. Yeah, what was the device that you wanted to cut it off with? What you were mentioning? What was it?
Was it meat kitchen? Cleaver?
Yeah, meat cleaver. Correct.
Is that how you would do it?
What, meat cleaver?
Yeah.
Would that be probably do the samurai sword thing. It's pretty sharp.
I wouldn't do it at all.
That's it.
If you had a choice.
End the story.
Well, how would you want it done?
None. At all.
No, it had to be done.
You kill yourself first, right?
Exactly. What the
you
hell?
Had a knife in front
no,
of you.
No, bob it. Yeah. No.
But what were you saying, Chris? You were saying something, though.
What?
Never mind.
Oh, no, I'm just saying about, like, you know, I was just trying to prove a point. Like, you know, it's like, then again, it's a belief. So, I mean, like, you know, who are we to say, you know, what was right or wrong. This is the fact that it was media attention.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
it. I mean, it fueled it by media. Like, it was by nobody who just did it and probably didn't go to a halfway house. No one would care.
John Bobbitt.
Exactly, you know. But he had his wife do it.
That was nuts.
That's the one she threw it out.
That's all, yes, that's all he had left was nuts.
Actually, yeah. You know what? Just not recently, but maybe a couple years ago, he had it attached. He has it back
like
now.
Reconstructive surgery.
Yeah, reconstructed surgery.
Right.
He's no longer.
Wow.
Yeah, but he had it reattached, and he ended up doing some adult films.
Yes, I was going to get into that.
And his name is John Bobbitt? I was going to say, did the wife at least Bobbitt before it was gone?
No, that was just a really, really horribly placed irony. That's his real name.
But I think that's what he was made for, Bobbitt. That's a straight porn name right there,
yeah,
dude.
Yeah.
There you go. There you go. So, yeah, you guys, when you do drugs, make sure you don't push the limit, especially when it comes to your genitals.
Cocaine's a hell of a drug.
Hell yeah, that's for sure. All right, guys, we're going to go ahead and take a quick music break, and this one is another Club Starter track. It's a remix by by Club Starters. It's the Ed Sheeran remix, or Redrum, Lego House.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. We're going to play here on the Slam Show, and we'll have their interview segment, talk about all their efforts behind their remix company, and Jason D is going to explain every single tattoo he has on right now. That's for sure. We'll be right back here on the Slam Show.
Clubstarters.net.
I'm out of love, I'll pick you up when you're getting down. And out of all these things I've done, I will love you better now. I'm out of sight, I'm out of mind, I'll do it all for you in time. And out of all these things I've done, I think I'll love you better now. I'm gonna paint you by now. You in. If things go right, we can frame it and put you on a wall. And it's so hard to say it, but I've been it before. Now I'll surrender up my heart and swap it for yours. I'm out of touch, I'm out of love. I'll pick you up when you're getting down. And out of all these things I've done, I think I love you better now. Sight, I'm out of mind. I'll do it all for you in time.
passenger, and I keep you sheltered from the storm that's raging on. Now I'm out of touch, I'm out of love. I'll pick you up when you get down. And out of all these things I've done, I think I love you better now. I'm out of sight, I'm out of mind. I'll do it all for you in time. And out of all these things I've done, I think I love you better now. I'm out of touch, I'm out of love. I'll pick you up when you're getting down. And out of all these things I've done, I will love you better now.
Yeah, that's a little re-drum edit by our special guest, the Club Starters, Lego House, Ed Sheeran track. I like that, brother. Kept it simple.
Yeah.
Kept it filled. Which one of you guys dabbled?
Oh, pretty much Jason dabbled.
Okay.
Pretty much.
It was one of those tracks that just, it was a cool, you know, soft track that I just decided to re-drum.
I think he was going through the motion. He was going through the motions on that time.
Explain to our viewers what exactly re-drumming is.
Yeah, I want to know.
So re-drumming is basically taking the context of the original song and adding just like another beat to uplift it just a bit off of the original. I mean, you're not taking the context of the original away from it, but you're just trying to make it more, a little bit lively, a little bit more. I mean, for us in the DJ world, in the radio industry, it's more mixable. So we could play it anywhere, you know, like it already has a beat to it. It can go with the regular favorite songs you hear on rotation. But it also gives a better vibe to it.
It's not over the top.
Correct. And like, you know, we when we do our remixes, we try not to take the originality out of a lot of the songs. We kind of want the originality to speak for itself, but yet add a little bit of a twist of our own type of deal, and which works out for us, in, you know, as we work week to week. So, Jason dabbled with that one. Like he approached when he made the re-drum to it. I was like, you know, out of all the re-drums we've done, like, but this one's like really off the wall, off to the side type deal. Like, it's, you know, I think it's going to catch a bit of attention on the site. And, you know, and at that time when he approached me with it, I was doing his video remixes for him. So I was like, I had Ed Sheeran video and, like, you know, just to remix it. So a lot of people, like, we got a lot of good responses on the site saying, you know, hey, you know, this re-drum works. And then these were people not even in the Bay Area, like out of state, like you're looking at Florida, Kansas, like places we wouldn't have thought that, you know, it would reach and stuff. So so we're like, you know, we're like, as we are, we're open format DJs, so we're open to a lot of open like music, whether it's rock, country, or whatever. I'm like, we'll do it, because I mean, obviously, like country now, like you can remix a lot of country now, because country got so open formatted that it's kind of like an open format now. It's like you consider top 40 country, but like Taylor Swift is opening it up the doors with all of them. So
thank you, Taylor.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's like, it's total crossover. So it's like, you know, I thought, you know, we should be a part of that type of deal of remixing, because, I mean, you know, you can't always do EDM. You can't do hip hop all the time. You can't do all this, following the crowd, what they do. In order for us to be original is to
spread up the curve.
Yeah, think outside the box.
You know what? And we're catering too to, like, not just club DJs too, and radio. Like, it's like wedding DJs and mobile guys that do, you know, school dances that want to hear stuff like that. You know, I don't do anything like that. I know Chris does. That's why me and him talk a little bit about music, like what's a top 40, what's this, you know, like this Ed Sheeran that you guys just played. I even forgot I did that, you know. No, really, I you know, was it like 2 years ago or a year ago?
A year and a half ago.
Yeah, I mean, it's an old track. I mean, it wasn't nothing spectacular or anything.
It was
like
one of those tracks that it was popular, but it could have been, it needed just a facelift. You know, and
that's a good way of putting it.
Yeah, and that's what it needed. And then straight up, like, everybody's like, you know what, I think this track works out well. Some people are a little bit late on it. Mm-hmm. They go on our Vimeo and they go, hey, I saw that video. And like, when that Ed Sheeran video came out, like, we did a long time ago. I was like, dude, this works like the school dances. I was like, school dances?
Exactly.
Really?
There you go.
That's when it comes down to, like, when we do stuff like that, that's mainly what a lot of the DJs pick up, you know, stuff like the Ed Sheeran's. All that stuff.
Yeah, but also starts with your ear, knowing that this song has a potential, because you can't just go ahead and pick any song and put in hours of work and it doesn't go anywhere. Exactly. So you guys bring your ear to the table, and that's what makes all this work for the Club Starters and your guys' efforts.
Well, radio helps. I mean,
you could go to a record pool, like any record pool, and get just a regular intro with no beat, and it sound flat, you know, when you're spinning.
And you're going to sound like every other DJ.
And it's just, this one just gives it more of a kick, snare, you know, just a cool kick.
Clip. So, that's what the re-drumming is. Yeah.
That's why I played it.
Yeah.
And I know Cindy liked it, because she loves the musicianship and great music textures, not the freaking dot, 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 and then it's just redundant.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's just straight up like you're in a trance a little bit.
Exactly. So let's kind of back up with your guys' background, starting with you, Jason. Talk about your radio history, club history, Justin.
Well, radio, I've been doing radio since, I want to say like 19. Jazzy put me on, I think the year was like 1997.
Jazzy Jim from 99.7
Jazzy
Jim,
yeah, I was Wild 107 at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And I sent a tape. I was like, I think I was like 14, 15.
Jesus Christ.
I was really young. I think younger than that. I think, yeah.
Well, he had to sign a release form from his parents.
They had a work present.
My parents were really supportive. Without them, like, they helped me out a lot, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I was like young, so I, you know, they were talking about, you know, sending in some demos and stuff, you know. I heard
on cassette.
Yeah, cassette.
Cassette.
So I had a cassette player. I actually taped it, you know, myself doing a live set.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, I had I was working with, I believe it was the 1800s. It wasn't even the 1200. It was the 1800s.
These are the turntables, ladies
yeah,
and gentlemen.
The 1800 turntables, and then it was just a regular Newmark mixer.
Yeah.
So then I made it this mix. I sent it in. Then I got a response from Jazzy. He called me and he invited me to, you know, they had like a meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And it was at the Wild 107 station over on, was it not Townsend, but the other
on Green Street.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I ended up going. I met everybody. It was cool. You know, I met Jazzy. I met Crystal Rebel, Scotty Fox, Rich Loxamana, Greg Lopez, you know, a lot of the big time DJs, you know.
And so, that was your first foot in the door in the industry.
Yeah, that was the first, you know, the first step. And after that, it was like me just proving myself, like just, you know, getting to talk to everybody, network. And I had my first time that Jazzy gave me an on air. When my first time on air was 5 o'clock. It was a 5 p.m.
That's a lot of pressure.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's
5
a busy
PM.
Time.
Yeah, it was Saturday. Traffic. It was a Mickey Ficky mix weekend. Mm-hmm. Jazzy just called me. He's like, you're on at 5 p.m. I'm like, whoa, 5 p.m.? I thought I was going to do
5 a.m.
Yeah, something like exactly. So I did the 5 p.m. and then Greg Lopez was there. So he kind of like helped me out, like with, the, you know, because they had the Rain MP24 at that time. I didn't know how to run that. I was like, what the heck of all these channels?
Yeah.
Then I seen the third turntable. I'm like, whoa. Okay,
it was just pretty overwhelming at that point.
It was. So after, you know, I did that and I came home, I listened to my mix and I'm like, God, I need to get a third turntable. You know, I want to do these power mixes. And,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, my dad went out, got me pretty much everything. I got the, he's like, well, what do they have at the station? Just tell me what they have. I'll get you whatever they have.
Oh, so great dad.
Must be.
Yeah.
Nice.
So at that time I was, you know, I had got the Rain MP24, had the three turntables, the 1200s. I moved up from the 18 to 12. And it was. You know, I just started evolving from there. You know,
that's
I started
awesome.
I would practice like every day. Like I wouldn't even do my homework. Like, you know, I was in school at that time. I was
academics had to take a step back, right?
Yeah, I was really.
Everyone from C's to D's, right? Something like that.
But
C's to like nine.
But he still
school.
Got to keep his turntables. Man, you lucky.
Yeah.
Guy.
Yeah. Dad was just on it. Hooked it up.
As soon as I got that, I started, you know, doing more, you know, radio at that time was like a lot to me. Like, I didn't think of clubs. I didn't think of, you know, oh, I'm going to DJ the clubs or anything like that. I was more like doing radio, and then radio kind of brought me to the clubs like really early too when I started, did a guest show with the Doghouse.
You would probably been what, like 15 at that point?
Yeah, I was like 15.
Yeah, doing 21 and over
clubs. Soda.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So, yeah, it was a... I that's where I started meeting everybody, you mm-hmm. know, in the industry, and
you started early.
Yep,
that's good.
That's so smart.
Chris.
Yes. How far are we going back on this one?
From the greatest from memory,
day one.
Yeah, no. Day one.
Well, no, I've been in the game for. I always say when I first started about 23 years ago. I started young, so I didn't start in 1990.
Okay.
Literally, so from there, I mean, you know, doing your typical house parties, da da da. I always wanted to get into radio. I mean, I've always listened to Jazzy when he was on Hot
97.7,
mm-hmm. the local radio, San Jose radio. So I was just like, yeah, you know, I want to be on radio too. But then, like, so towards near my high school years, like around probably about 94, 95, that's where I kind of caught my break a little bit. And like, I started hanging out with Ron Reeser, DJ Architect.
Yes.
From back in the days. Yeah. Shout out to Ron. He jump started my career. I started taking along with him to Wild, mm-hmm. To when it was Wild 94.9. And when they changed over from Wild 107, started taking along with him. And then Jazzy was, you know, obviously running the game out there. And then, like Jason, you know, giving demos. But, like, at least Jason got the invite for the demo. I kept going to Jazzy's office and throwing demos at him. I was like, here's my tape. You know, here's another tape.
You didn't bring the pizza with the cassette in it and just say, here, Jazzy.
You know, if I thought about that, if there was, like, some prize, I would have done that. I never thought. I was like, how shy. Here's my tape and just run off like a little kid, right? I was just like, you know, I need to get in here somehow.
Yeah.
So, yeah, throughout my high school years, you know, I've just been banging on clubs, mobiles, like a lot.
Filipino debuts and stuff.
So yeah, yeah, you know, just get your name. Yeah, well, not much of quinceañeras, but all the Filipino stuff. I mean, I do quinceañeras because I grew up downtown San Jose, so all my friends were Mexican. Mm. So the Hispanic, they tried to turn me to a little cholo DJ, but I didn't go that route.
Right, right.
So, and then throughout high school, I just kept hardening it out and, you know, still trying to keep up with the radio scene, try to get my foot in there. And until, like, probably I got my first foot into the door in radio, probably about 99, 2000.
Mm-hmm.
I got a mix show slot, thanks courtesy of Razor Rob. Well, 102.5 kid on in the Central Coast. I started there about 2000. And then from there, when starting my radio career, like, I did, like, a whole Friday night by myself.
Really?
Yeah, straight up. Like, they're all right. So you can,
like, 4 hours straight?
No, just start from 8 to 2.
Holy shit.
That's so
all night.
8 to 2. No, I was just like, overwhelmed. I'll do 8 to 2. Yeah, straight up. My record's over there. Do it live. And, like, you know,
I think he was making up from all the years that he was so.
Yeah. I'm going to mix live. So I did that. Like, all my boys rolled with me. My boys rolled
with me. Did you tape them?
Huh?
Did you take your sets?
Yeah, I taped a couple.
Do you still have them?
Yeah, I still have them.
All 12 hours of it straight?
Pretty much. Like, you know, you can hear, like, the fake drops on the side. Like, you know, like, it's, like, all the mess-ups. Like, you know, everything with live mixing is all about. And, you know, I mean, you don't hear that no more now these days. But, yeah, when I got into that, and then I had my shot right then and there at Wild. Jazz is like, all right, you know, you paid your dues. All those demos you sent me, hey, you know, you're on your own radio station. Hey, you know, come here and do a weekend with us. And
awesome.
Yeah, so I was just like, oh, cool. You know, I finally got to go see what this 3 turntable set up. But Jason always talks about Wild. I was like, you know, that was like the notorious. I mean, obviously, you know, being in the studios, like, you know, is
well,
like.
Well, let's kind of explain the whole 3 turntable thing, because a lot of people understand the 2 turntable and mixer. How does the 3rd turntable get incorporated for all the layman's out there?
Okay, so 3 turntables. So how we position here in the Bay Area is we have the 2 on the regular standard size, and you have the 3rd one on the top for easy access. The 3rd turntable acts just like if you're going to remix now these days. Like, you hear a lot of people doing remixes. So you could actually do it live. So back then, you had to have skills.
Even a mashup. I mean, mashups have been, have been around for a long time. I mean, that's why when they came up with mashups, I mean, it was basically a blend, a cappella over instrumental or something. So, I mean, that when that term came out, that word, I was like, mashup.
Yeah, but this time, back, you know, in the day, back then, you had to really work for it.
Yeah,
back in the day,
it was called a mega mix.
Exactly. Yeah. So, I mean, that 3rd turntable was to help you transition and help you be more creative on top of doing the 2 turntables. Now, more work, but more technical work.
That's right.
You know, now these new DJs probably never knew about doing technical work like we did back then.
There you go.
Like, you know, that's where the whole remixing mind came to mind. And then now that everything's so digital, man, this is like, really? Like that, you don't have to do anything with a turntable now these days. You can just walk around with a laptop these days. And, like, you know, you don't need no type of controllers. And that's what the sad thing about this culture is, that, you know, we're being perceived like that. And, you know, like, you know, I'm glad there's, like, a very few of us that still keep that DJ culture in the hand, that we still use these old tools, the turntables, the 1978 design. That turntable was born when I was born.
Have them right here.
Exactly. You know, I'm like, you know, the history, just knowing that. Not many people would tell you, like, oh, they knew that turntable was made in 1978. I knew because I try to learn the culture, not besides the mixing portion of it, the history.
Foundation.
You know, exactly. You know, you
and
need
I think
to,
that's what a lot of the young generation is like missing out.
Right,
like,
right.
It's like,
oh,
they,
I see where
they,
this is going
now.
They'll
never get the experience what me, like a lot of the DJs experience, you know, the live mixing. I'm sure there's a lot of people still doing the light, like Chris told me Kadon's still doing.
We don't do live mix. But I mean, no, I know.
It's all
Wild,
pre-taped, right?
Yeah, everything's pre-recorded. I mean, everybody knows it. I mean, it's not a big mystery no more. I mean, people will wonder, like, oh, how can so-and-so be on the way to the club when his mix is on the radio?
Exactly.
Yeah.
No way
so, I mean,
he is,
you know,
teleporting.
Exactly. You know, we got private jets that come from the club to our house to the station. We just got it like that. But no, I mean, it's, you know, there's very few stations now these days around the nation that still do live. I mean,
correct.
Obviously, you know, Wild still does it. You know, Majestic Chris, Jay Espinoza, They're out there.
Power 106 in LA.
Power 106 goes live. I mean, the big markets.
Yeah. Right, right.
There's budget for that. I mean, now it gets more political. So,
well, because everyone wants to go on the air, and they'll say, okay, kid, you want to get on the air? Put together a mix, and you're on the air.
Well, yeah. Now these days, I mean, with the internet so wide, I mean, you know, they're just doing their own Ustream shows. They're doing, you know, they're finding ways, the free ways to market themselves, which is great. You know, I embrace technology. But you kind of got to know the history of, like, how things were, you know, at least know a little bit of history.
I agree. Yeah. You have to be a historian to a certain degree in order to respect everything that you're having now.
Correct.
Now, let's go ahead and go into some sensitive issues. I know you have one foot in the old school vinyl days and the other foot in today's digital technology. Mm-hmm. Knowing that you have the greatest tools now versus back then, and now you're seeing the good and the bad, how do you feel the good technology is helping you make the things happen better as far as DJing and your remixes and edits are concerned?
Well, you want to answer that first, or I'm going to go with this? So,
I mean,
go ahead.
Well, are you talking about, like, more, like, as far as, like, the DJ-wise, as far as Serato and vinyl, or, like, actually, like, Ableton, Pro Tools, and stuff like that?
Yeah, just the overall digital technology now today versus back
these days
then.
To make an edit or a remix, you could just do it off Ableton or FL Studio, like, very simple. Mm-hmm. Before, to make a remix, you have to actually go to a studio and, like, lay down the whole, you know, it's more extra work back, you know, how it was back in the day.
Productivity is much higher. Like, I think you get more work, like, with the technology now, you get work done more faster.
Well said.
Yeah, yeah, basically.
Yeah, faster and cleaner, I think. I mean,
You know, we used to do it cleaner back then. I mean, it's just that, you know,
I hear
if you were to have some kid do it now, the ancient stuff that we used to use back then, they'd be like, they'll take them hours. Which would have always took them like 5 minutes.
I hear a lot of the difference from the sound quality and how records were pressed back in the days and now.
Yeah.
I hear a big difference. I know, to me, that's one thing. The mixes have to, the edit has to be super clean, mastered very well, mm-hmm, to get that good sound.
Exactly.
I mean, I listened to some old, like, some edits or tracks before, like, way back, and I'm like, you could hear the difference. I don't know. I just hear that muffleness, like, And with technology these days, you know, everyone's mastering their own stuff now, and you got Ableton, you got all these bunch of programs.
pretty much put all the big studios out of business.
Pretty much, yeah. Pretty much.
I mean,
yeah. Cool, cool. Well, I'm gonna go ahead and have my co-hosting staff ask a few questions. We're gonna start off with Joe, working our way around.
It's more of a question on, because I see that you guys are really passionate about how the new school is really just oblivious to the real grind. I mean, the real, like, from your story saying that you had a passion, you focused on it, and you had a goal, and your goal was to get onto the radio. And then you're able to see these opportunities just come out of nowhere because you had a focus, you had a common purpose, again, for you as well. And just all the new technology that you were able to see, like, you never really got to see the 3 turntable setup in a studio, but you heard somebody talk about it and you knew it existed. Did you guys ever think about, like, creating a video about you guys' kind of, like, history and what you went through, and then kind of putting it together for, like, you know?
I was actually thinking about putting, like, a video of, like, how we do our everyday, like, edits and remixes, because a lot of people, I get hit up a lot. Oh, how do you, you know, programs do you use? Yeah. How do you edit? And I was thinking maybe doing like a tutorial or something of clip starters and just kind of going off that.
That'd be awesome.
You know, I mean, I get hit up a lot. So does Chris. And I thought about something
like
that.
Yeah, there's a market for that.
Yeah, there is.
And I feel like you guys have a lot of, you know, a lot of background. You guys have a lot of experience and knowledge and wisdom that you could share with a lot of people. And again, I mean, you could DJ your whole life and, you know, it'd just be you. But if you could share that wisdom and that experience, they'll live on.
Yeah, there's some people who do videos. I like pretty much like a little bit of like a history for kids, like a little after school type thing. So they kind of give them like a history of like what the DJing thing is. Like, you know, they try to teach them like not to use a laptop type deal. They brought them into with 2 turntables, a mixer, and 2 pieces of vinyl.
Awesome.
Yeah. You know, and they do like these after school programs. And I forgot what these places. They have something in the Bay Area. Like, they're like almost like DJ academies, sort of. It's almost like becoming like a DJ university.
Is it like Kubert's? or different?
Different, because Cubers, they're teaching you more on like how to be on the technical scratching type thing.
Mm. Turntablist.
Yeah, turntablist type stuff. These other programs that I heard about, I forgot the names of them, but they're basically going back to the basics, like that we were talking about, like without the whole YouTube thing, but they're bringing kids after school, pretty much just keep them out of trouble, but yeah. then yet they're are involved, like they want to be
learning
involved. Learning with the industry of music. And they had these volunteers who just bring like two, like a bunch of turntables and mixers and vinyl, no laptops, no speakers, whatever, but they teach them like the basics. This is how you mix. This is what you do. This is a record. Some of these kids are just like, wow, like most kids when you go in a gig, they're like, wow, can I touch it? Like, is that real vinyl? What is that? Or, they don't even know what vinyl is. They're like, what is it? They don't know this material. So they teach these kids like back to the basics, even a little bit of history.
Yeah.
Like it's almost like class. Like, they'll tell you the turntable was invented this time and and this is what makes two things go together and this is how the needle works. Like total back to basics, and which is really cool. And eventually a lot of them do become like DJs, but some of them just do like an after school type thing.
Yeah.
But then I like to see that. It's just the fact that it gives back to the community of giving the culture of what DJing really is, because nowadays you see like commercials, everybody's a DJ. What does a normal Old Navy commercial have to do with anything with DJing, with selling clothes? I mean, there's a culture within it, but now they're just showing like that DJ doesn't do that. Certain things are not plugged in. That's not supposed to be where it's supposed to be.
Oh, those are embarrassing as fuck.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's
now
kind of like a style now. Like people think it's a style to be a DJ, or I'm gonna be cool, like, or I'm gonna get hella girls because I'm gonna be a
it's
DJ.
It's like the new rock star. Like,
do you get hella girls though?
It's like so I'm kind
of. It's the attention. It's the attention. Yeah, it's totally the attention.
And it doesn't work like that. You gotta,
in reality, you have the drunks falling all over your station, like, hey, play this.
Yeah, I mean, DJ's been blown out of context with a lot of this advertisement. I know it sells. I mean, great, make your money, but now you're just you're compromising our careers. People who do it full time, like me, Jason, and Sam, that they think that anybody could do it. Like they just think that we just picked up a laptop and went straight to the gig.
And it don't work like that.
It doesn't. I mean, they go in it for the wrong reasons. I had like family, friends, and all that who try to think they got into it, like, oh yeah, I want to become a DJ because I'm the center of the attention.
Oh, there you go, call them out.
I'll call them out. I don't know if they don't watch the show, but I mean, my boys know who's watching the show. They know some of those people. Like, it's like they get in for the wrong reason. They get into it because they like the attention. They get all the girls. They get to have free drinks. They live off. I get to walk the records in front of the whole big line in front of the club, and look at me, I'm the DJ. But when you get there, the other dude's DJing, and you're just the one who just carry the records in. And it's like, the attention getter. And that's great and all, but now you're just killing the culture, the what we grew up knowing as, like, this is the way it's supposed to be.
Yeah, well said.
Yeah. So yeah,
cool. I appreciate you guys sharing your guys' story. It's really cool, man.
Cool.
Yeah, kind of all that put together reminded me a lot of things too, especially for a guy like me that wants to be an up and coming broadcaster, and it's so hard for the people that have spent years training their voices in whatever capacity they've done. For me, it was acting, singing. A bunch of different projects, voiceover work, and now it's becoming increasingly hard to make it as a professional broadcaster because you just see ex-athletes just automatically jump into the game.
Mm-hmm. Oh, correct.
As something to do, it's
Shaq.
Like,
he became a DJ. What the hell is that about? Oh,
dude. They just know the right people. They put together that pedigree at the professional level in their sporting career, and then they just automatically get the free acceptance in there. I guess my question for you two guys is, these guys that kind of, as you were saying, kind of just about wanting to be in it for the wrong reasons and everything, and with all these different media outlets that allows people to get into the business easier, and with there being more competition, I guess, what do you guys do to separate yourselves from the competition? And in a way, for me, it's like I listen to the radio and I hear a lot of the songs that sound similar at like one particular time. Like in a summer season, you'll hear like six beats that all sound almost exactly the same. So is it kind of less challenge? Like, do you guys feel like you're less challenged now? Like it's maybe too easy to mix things with things sounding similar? I mean, was it more of a challenge when it seemed like maybe back in the day there was a lot more different kind of music that you were having to mix and make something out of? So it's kind of a two-part question. First off, how do you separate yourself from the guys that are in it now with all this competition? Then secondly, is it easier now with all these similar sounding beats or what have you.
Well, I mean, oh, you want to ask for the other one?
Well, first of all, radio, you know, has to be a typical format. You know, there is still playlists given to us what we should play by every hour. Do I follow it? No, I don't follow it because usually the program director usually knows what we are going to play a little bit, so he knows we're not going to wild out. So it's more like being creative of like, what can you be different, you know, instead of playing, like you said, the same thing. But yeah, you know, if you're talking about radio, it's going to be kind of like the similar stuff, you know, but it's you as a mixer, on-air DJ, to be a little bit different, you know. I mean,
well, now these days, I mean, like, obviously, I mean, DJing back then till now, I mean, there's a big difference. Back then, it was all about the art and skill. Yes. For us to keep our job, like, we were known, like, oh, that's so-and-so, that's Jason D, he could really rip it up on the turntables. Now Jason D, 20 years later, he's been in the game. Oh, Jason D, do you have like 100 friends and can you sell 10 bottles at a club? You know, that's the difference. That's now we have to be marketers now. Yeah. I mean, it's like, now it's not we're not being booked as DJs, we're being booked as promoters, but that's not our job,
right?
So in order to answer your first question about like how do we keep ourselves in the game, it's like, you know, one, we keep up with technology. I mean, we have to embrace it. We can't push it away. We just go along with it because the next person is just going to do it. So if the next person does it, they're just going to get them than us. So we have to keep up with that. Second of all, keeping your name out there. You know, as bad as it sounds, social media is what it is. You know, most people won't book us just because, you know, our skill. They want to book us because, people keep talking about it. Like if you went to a club, and they said, you know what, you guys could get this person, Jason D and Christylez, they're really good. That club's going to be like, oh, okay, they'll take mind of it. But they're really listening. And then next person comes in and be like, yeah, I heard, they'll probably be hearing a conversation with somebody saying, oh, I've been hearing about this Christylez and Jason D and from Clubstar. They're pretty dope. They just rocked the show down the street. Now that club's going to be like, oh, I want to have them. Now it's all about like how much of a pool you have.
Just got to market yourself. Totally. Market yourself really different. Don't be like everybody else. I mean, you just got to be yourself. Don't try to be like, yeah, there's a couple people you could say, oh yeah, he's dope, you know, be like that, but just have your own style. Don't, like I said, like Chris said, just
be original. Be original, be yourself, and be humble. I mean, you know, that's the biggest things, like, you know, we embrace from the old school days is like, you know, we take every blessing we can, but we're humble when we get it. And sure. You know, and it's like, you know, totally like, you know, as much as it could be cutthroat type deal to try to compete with these guys that could be everyday DJs, it's just like, you know, we have to like totally like be versatile to be a part of it, but at the same time adapt to it. And you know, then that goes into your second part of your question about like with the music formatting. Like Jason said, it's like, you know, being on radio helps us format because it makes us a better formatting DJ, that we know how to play to the crowd. We don't play for ourselves. We play for the crowd. That's what we get paid for. The club gets us to pay to keep the crowd in there so they keep drinking. The club can care less what we play because as long as their bar sales are doing good, that's great. But then you can't have any bar sales unless you get people dancing on the dance floor. And that's our job as DJs, to be perfectly formatted. And I'll thank radio for that, because radio, I'm like, you know, anybody could play music and download from like a LimeWire or some type of iTunes.
That's still going on.
It still goes on. Yeah, you know, and it still goes. But you know, at the same time, you know, and then people will tell you, well, what makes the difference between that DJ and this DJ? And he just plays the same thing you do. I'm like, you know, but you gotta say, you know, gotta go back with the whole history. Like, well, okay, I've been doing it for this long. How long has that person been doing it? Mm-hmm. That's great. He sells bottles, but I do. Okay, well, check this out. I'll tell the owner, you hire him to be a promoter, you hire me to DJ. And that's what you're looking for. And they go, oh, you know, they just wake up like, it's really, you thought you could just, you know, I mean, it's great to have a DJ to have a great following too. But at the same time, you know, they don't understand, like, you know, our job is harder than just pushing a button. And some of us, you know, we really put work into it. Like we will put a show. There's a lot of the very few DJs that will still put a show, you know, and, you know, that will, people that will pay to come up just to see and like have a following, just the fact that they know that person's been around for a while. And great, you know, he's still doing his thing 20 years later, and he's keeping up with all these newbies and these new cats. And, you know, and that's how me and Jason, we try to keep our heads out there once in a while. Like, you know, as old as we are, I mean, we're not that old, but, you know, it's hard for us to get out, you know, at any time, at a given time, to just go to a club just to network. You know, and I tell them, you know, sometimes we have to do that, but sometimes, you know, we just can't do it. And, you know, and it's just to keep our face familiar with these newbies, to let them know that we're still around. You know, besides what we're doing on radio, you know, we're not old fogies. You know, we know what the new style is. It's just that, you know, just remember, we're still here. Sure. You know, we just try to keep faces familiar type deal. So
set the record straight.
Basically.
Yeah, freaking right, put the foot down. Tell these motherfuckers what's up.
Hey, man.
Fucking asses.
We're too old to go to jail, man. Back then, maybe.
All right. Well, like you said, you guys are really doing your part to keep up with what's current and what's interesting and relevant. Like, what artists do you find yourselves like, you know, this is our go-to, this is, you know, this is what's going to flood the bar and then the floor. Like, what are you really feeling right now as far as what you want to incorporate? And
well, first of all, I mean, like, we do our research when we walk into a club. Or, like, you know, some of us, we'll go there a night before or, like, the week before and see what people are playing, what people are feeling. You know, we're just not going to just walk in unless it's, like, we travel outside the area. But, I mean, you know, you go with familiarity. And, like I said, being on radio is an advantage for us. Like, anything that's played on radio is played on the internet and it's played everywhere. So everybody's familiar. So you know your go-tos. What's hot right now? Your Katy Perry's, your Pitbull's, you know, your Christina Aguilera's, all that type of stuff. You know, those are your go-tos. And then now it's all about formatting, how to format your hits and your recurrence. Recurrence are basically stuff that was hits back then, which people like, you know, like your Tupac's, your Biggie's and stuff like that. You incorporate that all into like a formula. So basically, you look at yourself like almost like a chef, sort of. Mm-hmm. You got your ingredients, and then when you get to the club, it's time to cook. Now, when you're cooking,
putting it, I like that.
That's a great analogy.
Yeah, I mean, you got if you're by yourself, you got to format throughout the whole night, so from opening from 10 o'clock till 2 a.m. You got to know what you play. You just don't play a straight hit right off the back. You might play a couple just to get the crowd out there. But, you know,
you're not dropping fancy at 9 o'clock.
Exactly. You're not trying to overwhelm them with new stuff because later on, I mean, and also, I mean, there's nothing wrong with doubling up on songs.
I was just going to say that. I'm like, you better not be doubling up on songs. It's okay.
It's okay because, you know,
I repeat a song like on, when was it? Friday. I repeated Fancy twice. I played it around
so
early.
Hot right now.
Yeah, early. And then also to the Little John, like Bend Over, that one. Like, I played it twice. Like, a lot of DJs like say, oh, I don't repeat songs, but sometimes you have to because some of the people early you drop. I like to drop some of the cool tracks, not all of them, not all the heaters, but most of like some of the good ones I could get away with. I'll drop in the beginning.
You'll know your boundaries of which songs you can throw in and what you cannot throw in.
And as far as for me, like new stuff, I'm always like online. I'm listening to what people are hearing. Like the Fancy came out, like Iggy, she's dropping a lot of new stuff. Like I told Chris about that a while back. I was like, dude, this chick.
At first, I wasn't feeling it.
Yeah, I was feeling it, you know, and there was a lot of cool tracks that.
But remixes I started feeling. Yeah. I was like, well, if it wasn't the original, the remix, I'll do it.
You know? I made it more club friendly for us DJs to drop. And I mean, after that, we just started kind of going off what people were even like. I would, even on Facebook, sometimes where people would, like, even the fans, like, out there, like, they'll be dropping a song. I'm like, oh shit, what is this?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Track's pretty cool, you know? And then.
So, I mean, like, typically to answer that, it's like, playing songs, like I said, more than once a night is okay. You gotta figure out like the people that weren't there want to hear it also again.
Right. And it has to be played separately.
Definitely.
It can't be like you're doing it at 9 and playing it at 10.
Oh no, I'm talking about like 9:45, 10-ish, and then dropping it again like 12:40, like 1 o'clock, 12:45.
Perfect. Yeah,
that's what I do. You know,
agreed.
And a lot of DJs disagree. I've seen posts that, I don't play. I can't believe this DJ played this song twice. I'm like, why? The song is hot. Play it twice.
And then it goes along with the context of radio. Have you ever noticed you guys complain like, dude, that song again? It just played like 20 minutes ago. But that means you're an avid listener because. The average listener only listens to about 10 minutes a day.
Radio, a track could get played like every hour. I hear it. Like
correct.
And that gets a little bit annoying. I mean, a lot of people.
But it's familiar music.
Yeah, it is.
It keeps the listener familiar.
The
and then
radio.
That's what they hear on radio. They're going to hear that. They want to hear that in a club.
Yeah.
So that's why there's nothing wrong with actually playing the song twice. As long as you could really keep the separation and kind of like even throw in a remix, it would be fine. Like, you know, like if a certain acapella that everybody knows but a different beat. Great, you know, then you can play the original later and then spike them up again. So it's total.
Do you not like DJs?
I'm a DJ snob, honestly.
What was that?
I'm a DJ
Sam,
snob.
How many times did you play? You play every 15 minutes the same song?
That's crazy. When you said that, you're like, you don't play the two songs. Like, is that
Well, the thing is that we got veteran DJs in the house, so we know the radio format, the powers, the spikes, the reoccurrence. We know that.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to admit, without that experience, Jason and Chris, we wouldn't be as efficient as we are today, knowing that you have to know the main songs versus the ones that you could bring back.
Correct.
And having that balance, because a lot of these, we were talking about this on the pre-show, where a lot of these DJs are getting these gigs that have no formatted experience in radio, correct, which is the most important thing to be effective in an open format situation at a club, because then you know which ones are the main hits, because there's only so many songs you could play a night. And you got to make sure every song is going to be efficient.
Correct.
Not something that you're just playing just for the hell of it. Mm. So,
and timing is everything. Timing, I've always, every time I'm DJing, I'm always looking at the time. Like, that's how I know, okay, now it's time to start getting these heaters.
Yeah, just to share something with you, one of the formulas that I go about is being able to transition from low tempo to up tempo. And there's I always look at the clock, and I'll share the secret, because this really works in the clubs that I do. And Mikey was over at the Brentwood location, because I played there for the first time and the place was packed. So I kind of had everyone at my control. So I wanted them to go on the journey, which is transitioning from different BPMs to another, beats per minute. And I always do it between a 20-minute and 30-minute time frame. So it'll be up tempo for that period and goes down hip hop, starting around 90 BPM. 20-30 minutes later, goes up to up-tempo, 130, and so forth. So it goes up and down throughout the whole night. So everything is balanced. Yep. You're not having like a whole hour of hip-hop. Oh,
of course, yeah.
So I bring that to the table, and I learned that from being in radio throughout all the years, is knowing that you have to change up the tempo because it keeps everything interesting.
Correct, yeah.
Agreed?
It keeps everybody happy, too. Yeah. Like, I mean, you get a lot of people that want to hear house, you want people, a lot of people want to hear hip hop. You know, you got to satisfy everybody.
Exactly.
And you're not just going to go in there and play 2 hours of EDM.
Yeah.
Like, it's, and like, if you can incorporate all that within, like, 30 minutes less and going back and forth, that's when you know you're pre-formatted.
Sandwich everything right. I mean, the right way, and the night will go good.
Exactly. I mean, exactly. And that's where, like I said, we share that general radio experience. Sure. And without radio and the mix show, kind of molding us, we wouldn't be as effective DJs as we are today.
Correct, yeah.
What's your toilet break song, real quick?
Toilet break song? A water bottle from the side I just finished like 2 minutes ago.
That's a good question.
Toilet break song? I mean, honestly, I have mixes already preset just in case.
I agree. That's what I have too. Because,
long song.
Yeah. Because sometimes the songs are too short
to me. You gotta get through the crowd just to get to the damn bathroom.
Exactly.
I have one of my buddies.
That's what happened.
I have one of my buddies just stand there. I'll just be like, I'm gonna be right back. I'm gonna use the restroom. Usher is like 4 minutes, I think. It's like the intro, the outro.
See, that's
like,
pretty short at some clubs because, like Chris was mentioning, you have to first fight through that main crowd, which is gonna take like 2 minutes, then go past the hallway area and wait in line, and that'll take forever.
I was gonna say,
so you're at the mercy of that situation.
When in doubt, play Rapper's Delight full version. What is
that? Oh, yeah, that's another one, too. Dude, or something like that. Yeah,
or SOS Band, Take Your Time, Do It Right. That's another like eight-minute, 9-minute.
Damn, you're scaring me, dude. So how'd you know all this?
You know, I, like I said, at Sac State, I hosted a slow jam show, and so that was always a thing, too. Is like, you know, I always wanted to mix the eras between, like, you know, I didn't want it all like new slow jams, I wanted to kind of, you know, throw a little bit of the Temptations, but then also bring it back to like a R. Kelly or Donnell Jones. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
and
so
you're scaring us.
Baby making over there.
It was called the Seductive Slow Jam Session.
Whoa! What's the voice? What's the voice?
Hey, I'm the smooth operator here at KSSU.com. Your Stevie Dreamy DJ providing you with all that bedroom knock.
You sound like that W ball. Hey. Snoop Dogg album. EW, easy nuts.
Yeah, right?
Oh, did we finish up the questions with
Sage
everyone?
Is next.
You guys forgot about me. It's okay.
They messed up.
Question. Quick ones, both to you guys. Speaking of DJ culture, how many records do you have in your collection, vinyl collection? And if so, which one is your most prized possession?
Ooh.
Ooh. Wow. That's, wow.
That is a great question.
That is a great question. That won't be all dead air.
Get ready.
Man.
Go ahead first.
I got so much.
Are you that somebody remix?
Damn.
That's
like,
you.
Oh, sorry.
Are you that somebody?
I would probably say like, I mean, like, I have like thousands of records. I still have all my vinyl in my studio. I mean, I made like a nice little showcase. I have a big ass studio.
Ballpark figure.
Ballpark figure. Like how many? over the 10,000s.
Wow.
10,000, wow.
Now I know where to go for vinyls.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, if my house burned down, I'll be a very sad guy. It's going to smell like shit after the fire, but most prized record.
I had a garage full of records. Like, I had so many. I mean, I don't think I have a couple left, but nothing like my real collection I had.
He stuck all his vinyl in his laptop, made it all this, he converted it to MP3. No. Man, my most, I probably would say I have, man, my original 12-inch to the Incredible Bongo Band.
Really?
Patchy.
Okay.
Wow. I mean, it's like, it's one of those, it's in the era.
The sample, the original sample, yeah.
It's a sample from the original era from all the breaks, from all the, when all the break dancers were like, you know, the B-boys.
Mm-hmm.
Had that, dun, 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 yeah, dun, dun. Like, you know. Having that 12-inch, I mean, it's more than just having it has history. Like, we're going back to, like, the culture of history. Like, because of that, you know, I did a little history thing about that song, like, what it's done for the world. And they did, like, a little thing on HBO, like a documentary about certain songs that changed the world.
Mm-hmm.
That song was, like, adapted with the culture of when hip-hop was changing, like when hip-hop was invited to, like in the 70s and 80s, and when DJing culture started, and it was part of like the Watergate scandal. Ooh. I was just like, what? Like Nixon? Like, what?
You have the original?
I have the original 12-inch, yeah. But then, like, just knowing the reason why I would pick that record is the fact that it has history. I'm kind of a little bit of a history junkie, and not just because of DJ culture history, but the history itself of, you know, of America and the world. And, you know, what started with, you know, certain songs made movements. That song made a movement in the history of what DJing culture is now today. Mm-hmm. Whether it's B-boy dancing, DJing, scratching, everybody has sampled that record. And everybody knows from the drum to the percussion to the hi-hat was sampled to what makes music today.
I remember that.
So I make that my number one record because it has so much history and culture behind it. And stuff that doesn't even have to do with music but yet changed the world. You know, I mean, music's so powerful. You know, like it's an international language that everybody can understand. Like, we don't even have to speak English in here. If you can like one song, I like another song.
Yeah.
Right.
The aliens will understand
just
like
it. That.
Almost
just like
Game
that.
Of Planet of the Apes type thing, right? But I mean, you know. But yeah, I mean, that's probably my most prized record I have in my 12-inch collection. I don't know what Jay does. Maybe Britney Spears or something.
Yeah, you have to have some record
Cher.
Left.
I used to play the New Order, Blue Monday.
The beach, flip side.
The instrumental side I used to play a lot. It was rare. So I still have it.
There you go. Don't let go of that.
I still sample it.
No, that's...
Why not?
You know, I found that record in France.
I still
vinyl junk it, really, like, you know, to a point that if I don't travel, but then if I can find it on eBay, I found it, and it's like people know the value of these records, like, you know, I think that one was selling for like, I mean, like 60-80 bucks,
the New Order one.
Yeah, I mean,
wait, the New Order Blue Monday, what's the difference with the vinyl, how it looks?
It's just the originality with the first pressing, because a lot of it was repressed.
And the first press, what, they didn't have the instrumental, from what I heard, right?
No.
It didn't have the instrumental. I had the instrumental.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So that it brings value. I mean, there's value in these records.
And I still have that one. I think
stuff that you would not find on iTunes type deal or find on the LimeWire or anybody would share. I mean,
LimeWire again
or Napster.
A lot of LimeWire back
there. One more quick question for both of you guys. Do you guys have a custom turntable?
Do we have a custom? No.
Well, you gotta go see DJ Henry.
I know Henry. Like, I spoke with him. Yeah, shout out to Henry. Yeah, I mean, that guy works wonders with turntables. I mean, I give it up to him.
And
I mean,
he works wonders with these. Exactly. That's for sure.
Exactly.
We'll take a look at it after the show.
But I give it up. Like, you know, like he found a market in the DJ industry to where people could pimp out turntables. He's like the exhibit of turntables.
Mm.
He pimps them out, like making the dicer in the turntable. That's magnificent. I never have thought someone drilling holes and putting this actual dicer, like dicer is a controller that you can trigger things. It's built in the turntable. Henry really knocked it out of the park with that one. I give it up to him. I mean, I don't know him personally, but I see his work online and everything, and I spoke with him to do some work, but he does a lot of originality. I mean, like, pimping out the turntable, putting stickers on it, that's cool and all. I'm not really that type. I mean, some people like it because it brings, like, the originality of what people portray themselves. Like, oh, I want a Superman because I love Superman.
Yeah.
What would you do yours?
What would you pimp out?
Yeah, what would you pimp out?
Commando style camouflage. No, I don't know. I mean,
a big old penis on it.
With Jason Lee's face next to it. with the monkey.
You're more the functional. You want something that functions.
No, I mean I'm all about originality. I like it to be original. I you know, like, people think I'm boring about it. Like, you know, when you go to my studio, my thing's straight up the way it was when it was built back in 1978. Straight up original one. Like, I just don't feel like masking it with anything, because I feel like I'm disrespecting the culture of how it was built. That design is like, you know, everybody's trying to copy it, and to this day that techniques got bought out and then they went discontinued. These things went hot commodity, man. They went from like being $300 turntables to like $1,000 turntables.
So what would you customize yours as? Your face? I mean, have your face on there? I mean,
he just said it with his with his
Jason
penis
D's face with a penis.
Oh, you were serious?
He said, no, he wants to put my face on there.
I mean,
among other things.
I'm not really into like I say, the customize, but I would probably do like different colors, like, you know, like the way like, you know, like
Philippine color.
Huh? The Philippine flag.
I still have my turntable. I hardly even use them.
You have a 1200 still?
I still have my 1200s, yeah. And okay. I got a controller, one of those Pioneer ones.
I have that.
I actually like it.
I have
it.
That too. Yeah, everyone does.
I think I mean, I always love turntables. I always respect the turntables. But,
yes, sir.
Kind of like when so I'm at the clubs. If I'm at the club, no, but I would not want to use turntables.
But let's go back to the customization. What would you have it as?
Yeah, what would you have?
We already know what Chris wants.
What would you put on your turntable?
I mean, no. He wants my face on there.
With the Philippine colors.
With a monkey.
I don't know. I'd probably put my logo.
Okay.
My DJ logo.
That's it?
You wouldn't. Yeah. How about your press picks? The one with just your wife beater on with all your tats.
What?
Yeah, this guy has a major press picks, man. You should check him out. Yeah, like, dude, this guy was like.
That's where I got the made the flyer for the show. I kind of crept up on his page and.
Oh, that was a little bit of the older one. Oh. You should check out some of his newer his hard body pictures.
He did. Okay. Oiled
up
stalking.
And all. Yeah, dude. Like, you know.
I probably just put my logo something.
Not you standing like butt naked with your tattoo showing.
No. Going like
I think if I toured like a lot with turntables, I would probably dress it really crazy, so that because when they're like doing videos of you, they're gonna show your equipment, so I probably would put something crazy, but I just don't know what I would put. It's just in the moment feeling type deal. But yeah, logos are cool because you get to promote yourself, but I mean,
you could always do that with slip blades, you know.
True
I mean, it's I just feel like it does have no function to have it so pimped out. Like,
I know I'm with Chris on that.
Like LEDs.
Like, I would just.
I love it,
like,
bulb.
I have the black ones, just plain black. It looks so much cleaner.
Yeah, I mean,
it has a clean look.
It doesn't make you a better DJ when you have it pimped out.
I've seen the ones that handle.
Can't hear you, Jace.
Gets down.
Yeah, you gotta get on your mic.
Gets down. But to be honest with you, I think that clean look, just the originality of the turntable, looks just clean to me.
Fair enough.
I wouldn't pimp it out.
You know,
I wouldn't.
That would probably go along with like how we respect the culture about DJing, you know, like respect that form of that turntable versus like we respect what's his name cutting off his penis and jumping off a building. I mean, respect it. I mean,
well, let's kind of go into another respect situation, because earlier today you found out that someone was impersonating you online. Let's talk about that real quick.
Oh man, here we go, dude. Everybody's gonna get a crack on this one, right?
Yeah, what happened?
So I guess this is guy. Do I have to put his name on here?
Put it out.
So this guy, I mean, like, you know, I mean, I'll give him a shout out. He's been gaining some fame off this one, but.
That's crazy.
So he goes by the name of Christylez, but it's spelled Christylez. I go with a Z at the end, without an E. And so this guy, he goes by the name of Chris Wong, from what I know. And
yeah, they're typing that in the chat room right now.
There
Chris
we
Wong,
go.
Chris Wong.
And this guy's he shops on our site. Periodic, like he's on it. Like,
oh, he's a customer.
He's a customer.
He's like,
okay.
A customer,
yeah, total customer. You better speak on the mic, buddy. And so he's a customer. So I didn't wanna scare him off. He's spending money on our side. We're getting money, and you know, I try to keep it as professional as possible. And this guy like keeps messaging me on the back end, like, hey, can you hook up this remix, do this and that, or I'm having a problem downloading. Can you just give it to me for free? I'm okay. You and I will please go through the proper channels of emailing. Da 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 da.
Yeah, customer service.
Customer service at clubstars.net. And he goes, okay. Then he stops for a while. Then he goes off, starts bad mouthing on the side, like to like some of my DJ friends, like, oh yeah, you know, I know that Christylez. I tried battling for the name. He didn't want to battle me. And I was like, and then my other friend who knows me, she's like, she DJs also. She's like, is that the Christylez that I know? She's like, yeah. He's like, yeah. He's like, you know, he didn't want to battle for the name, so he backed down. And then my friend was like, okay. And these are like kind of close DJ friends. You know, so and I'll say, all right, I'll let that slide. You know, I'm like, I'm not about to have beef on the internet. People are just brave typing away. Do that in front of my face.
Trolling.
Yeah, Oh, is that what it is? So, so you get, I let that slide for a while, and I guess these feeds keep coming. So I blocked him because I blocked this guy. He ends up.
Well, that pissed him off.
It totally pissed him off because he came back messaging my fan page. Saying you're a horrible human being. And you give Filipinos a bad name. I was like, oh my God, really, dude? Here we go.
Pull the race card.
He pulled it off. You know, and just because he's Filipino too, I'm like, yeah, great. And I go, all right. And then I found out when he gave me that post, my picture on his profile.
Yeah.
Talk about stalking, right?
I was the one that told him. I'm like, who's this Chris Long guy? Because he hits me up talking about remixes and all this stuff. And I'm cordial with the guy. I don't know. You know, I'm cordial with everybody that hits me up. I'm not, like, going to judge or anything. But finding out that he's doing all this shit to Chris, and I'm like, who's this guy?
I was furious, man. I was just like, and my wife first told me to back down. I was like, all right, cool. I'm going to back down.
Uh-oh.
Second time around, when he started posting my picture, and she's like, oh, he went there. My wife's pretty calm. She's all.
I called you this morning. I think I told you. I was like, dude, you know he put your.
Yeah, but then other people started messaging me too. They started taking screenshots. Like, look, dude, it's
infamous
you.
Screenshots.
The infamous screenshots. And they're just like, you know, all my DJ friends. And they're just like, I was just like, this got to stop. So I told Jay, I'm like, hey, hit this guy up on a personal tip. Ask politely. Take off the picture and just be respectful. And he goes off bad mouthing me still. He goes, oh, I apologize. I'll take it off. But, you know, but Chris had to be all childish and block me, da, da, da. You know, I'm just trying to protect my privacy. And, you know, as much as, you know, I do network a lot because I have to for my job because I do this for a living, I have a family. And I got to protect that too.
Yeah.
You know, and like, you know, and it's like, you know, if my wife sees that and, you know, my other family sees that, I'd be like, whoa, what's that? Why is he attacking you on a personal tip? You want to make that, you want to handle this? I'm really
we're going to go downtown San Jose on your ass.
Exactly, right? We'll go ESJ on you. But I mean,
yeah.
You know, I mean, but I'm not about that because I will lose business and then I won't be able to provide for you and the family. You know, it's
there's
like
ways of handling it.
Correct. And, you know,
I'm totally shitting this motherfucker.
I was about to get down. I was like, the gangster almost came out of me. The thug life on my chest almost came out. Tupac style. But
stalking you and watching you right now.
No, he probably is. He's probably listening to the show, this and that. We promote it, and he's on the Clubstarter site and stuff like that. That's great. You know, I mean, it's pure, you know, he could take off the context right now. What I'm saying is, it's like, you know, if you're in, he DJs. So like, if you're in the industry, if you want to get in, fit in, don't be trying to start anything and you can't, you know.
I think
you
he was talking crap to other DJs on their flyer, right?
You can get a little closer to the mic too.
He was talking crap to the DJs on that flyer on.
Yeah, like he got on another flyer surfaced up with these other DJs from the North Bay, from San Francisco. It had nothing to do with us. And He went on the flyer making fun of people on the flyer, the DJs on the flyer. And, you know, it's like, you know, he was attacking other people that we don't even know. And these DJs are like, hey, dude, you know this DJ? And then they're all, hey, and then some other DJ, Maniacal, he's just like, I hope that's not the Christylez that I know. I was like, well, he would never do that. And he's just like, dude, but I hope not, man. It's just like, and then I went, and then my boy James tagged us. He goes, hey, man, he's like, someone's putting you on blast. I had to get on there and make the whole formal thing, say, that's not me, you know, it's an impersonator, and da-da-da.
Did you report him to Facebook?
See, I was going to get down to that.
Likeness?
I was going to get down to that, and also with the whole infringement with the picture thing.
Yeah.
And, you know, and then after Jason gave him that little message thing, he took it off and this and that, and, you know, and then I didn't do it. I didn't report him to Facebook. You know, I would just wait for something big. If something comes around, like, you know, big, and it does, I probably would report him, but it's just like, you know, I'm giving the guy the benefit of the doubt. You know, it's like I'm making it, you know, to other people out there who are listening to me and seeing me on the social network saying, dude, Christylez is not a bad guy.
I will send Jason D after all.
Yeah, I will send Jason there with a 22-inch dick in your mouth.
Oh. With a monkey.
With a monkey.
Yeah, I got to hear this monkey story later.
Yeah, you got to get this monkey thing. Yeah, but that was the whole beef thing. I'm like, you know, but the craziest thing is like some people say, yeah, girl, you must be like a lot of my friends were like, dude, you must be making a lot of noise with your career if people are talking about you. I mean, just, you know, with success, there's always hating.
Yep.
So, I mean, you know, they say that's what they say in this industry. Anything in the entertainment industry is that you have to grow thick skin. Just learn to flick it, walk away and forget, and just do your thing, man. Because the more you keep on with that, all that negativeness, it's going to bring down your production, your whole self-esteem, and just everything. You know, I could probably be the most meanest person at home just because this guy gave me a bad day. Mm-hmm. I'm not gonna let that happen. You know, that's what I told Jay. You know, we're running a business. You know, and like, you know, and it'll hurt business if we come out bad on it. So, you know, so
we get a lot of people that message us like some random weird stuff. You know, mm-hmm, but mm-hmm. as us being, like he said, a business, we have to be cool with everybody that messages. We're not going to just be like, oh, we don't help you. Like, I mean, we get messages, emails, like, we get hit up a lot. You know, right. We got this, you know, something went wrong, or we didn't get the track, but there, you know, the money didn't get through, the transaction didn't go through. I'm like, wait a minute, there's no transaction, you know? So,
yeah.
We get a lot of people like that just is out just for scam too, you know?
Yeah,
so,
course,
you don't know if
course.
The person, like, this whole Christylez thing, to be honest with you, I really think that. Is somebody that in the industry that is just hating.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't really think this is a real person. I don't think that this is a real person out there, because anybody could get an account. Anybody could go on there and start talking shit.
That's
and
right.
grow balls and, you know, start running his mouth. I mean, it's social media. You know how many these fake people, you don't even know if their fake accounts are real. You know?
I agree.
So I really don't think that this Christylez really even exists.
Yeah.
But
it goes down
be.
To this Chris Wong, and that Chris Wong
Chris
doesn't
Wong.
Really
it could
exist.
Be like a different person. Like
yeah.
It could
really
be a black dude if it could, you know.
Yeah.
I mean
but then again, there can it can be really a Chris Wong, you
right,
know.
Right.
And you know, he's probably watching right now. And
the cool thing
really
and the cool thing is that you're able to come on the Slam Show, set the record straight.
Oh yeah.
And it's going to reach to a whole who knows how many people and let them know the
Oh no,
part.
I was prepared for it. I mean, like, you know, it's just, you know, it's
I felt it, that preparedness.
Yeah. it's our image, you know. I'm like, you know, we can't go out being gangster. I mean, you could think we're faking the funk right in front of the show, but this is who we truly are. Like, we're all about being professional, respectful, and running a business. I mean, it's all about business. I mean, you know, it's, you know,
and being humble with everybody, talk to everybody, you know. I mean, that's no. I see a lot of like negativity too on Facebook besides this whole Christylez thing, you know, the fake. There's just a lot of people just smashing everybody on Facebook, talking crap about, oh, he's whack or he's this, and there's just like I don't believe
people
in
are just
everybody,
pretty
yeah,
brave, man, to
like,
type a lot of things.
It's
these
crazy
days,
out
well,
there.
That's,
man. Just,
that's what the internet invites. You have this so-called virtual Teflon plate in front of you that makes you get away with anything because no one could really find out who you really are unless they really research. But overall, you guys are two great individuals, and I wish you the very best as far as your careers go. And we're going to talk more about this on another program
definitely.
We only have so much time, but you guys are great. You guys are going to definitely come back.
Oh, definitely.
That's
Thank
for
you.
Sure.
Thank you for having us.
No, no problem. Due to time constraints, we're going to go ahead and do the shouts and plugs, and we'll go ahead and work our way around, starting with Joe time.
Yeah, man. First off, shout out to my boy Sam, and then, you know, just Mark and Chris and Lady Sage, Sin, and Mike on the mic, you know, appreciate you guys always. To everybody watching live, especially their fans, our fans, and everybody else's fans, and just continuing to watch the Slam Show every Monday. And to everybody out there that's going to go to my show, it's this Thursday. It's 2 weeks from now, Wednesday, the 30th, at Pleasanton, California, Tommy T's, Joe Time Comedy. It's going to be a great show. Let's have fun. Shout out to all my family and friends, man. You guys are awesome.
Awesome. Mikey.
Yeah. Shout out first off to Slammin Sam, man. Thank you for inviting me onto the show. I guess it should go deeper than that. Shout out to Ricky Mehta for having a birthday party at my sister's place. Shout out to my brother-in-law and my sister for throwing the party in which I was able to meet you that day. you know, shout out to my folks, the Overly brothers. One's listening from Arizona. One's watching from nearby in Oakley. Shout out to my parents for, you know,
conceiving you
for conceiving me and blessing me with the things that I've been blessed with throughout my first 29 years of life. You know, like I was talking to Joe, you know, I've been I'm very humble and very appreciative of everything that I've had up to this point. I can honestly say in my first 29 years of life that I've been able to do pretty much everything that's made me happy so far. And so, for that, it definitely my parents, probably are the greatest, ones to thank on that. So hopefully this is not a one and done situation. Hopefully I can come by again. I think you gave me an invite to come by on another show, so I'm extremely honored at that. Shout out to Cindy. It was great getting to know her. She was a comedy right when I got here, saying, "Hey, Kinders is on the table. Eat up." You know, thank you to Lady Sage for you know, kind of further promoting me through her Facebook with inviting me to tonight's event. And so, you know, the more people, like I was telling you, the more people that can follow me and the Mike on the Mic brand. By the way, my Twitter at Mike on the Mic 24. My Instagram at picmic 24, as in PIC, the short abbreviation for picture, and then Mike, the short abbreviation for microphone, MIC 24. Don't even bother trying to find me on Facebook, because I'm Michael Smith and there's a million other Michael Smiths.
You should just take a picture with a monkey we know it's you.
Yeah. Well, you can find me actually through the links of tonight's show, because I was one of the hosts and through that on Facebook. But yeah, definitely the monkey pic coming soon. So yeah, those are my shout-outs.
That should be your trademark, man. Every time you do some shows or whatever, bring the monkey out.
Bring the monkey. Well, my dad always, real quickly, little joke. He said when I was born, I came out real hairy. And he said, he asked the doctor, he said, "Hey, did I give birth to a chimp or did I give birth to a human being?" So,
wow.
You know, monkey.
Hey, there's a calling right there.
Monkey Mike, you know, I used to climb trees when I was little. I got the Nike symbol tattooed on my chest. So Nike Mikey's kind of always been a name I've kind of fluttered out there too, that I might, you know, promote within time. So a bunch of different avenues I could take. But yeah, nice. Monkey seems like the one that's really trending right
monkey,
now.
Monkey.
Girl. Oh, my goodness, Cindy.
Hard to top that. But yeah, thank you guests, thank you crew, special thanks to Kinders for that last minute adding on those ribs. Man, you guys rock. Thank you parents for watching my dogs, and thank you Jeremiah wherever you are, because I don't know. I don't even know where he's at. Get home safe. All right, go ahead.
Shout out to the guest, Christylez with a Z. Everyone get that straight.
Yeah. With a Z.
And Jason D, it was great seeing you again. And it was great meeting you the first time, Chris. And of course, to the crew, great meeting you in person, Mike.
Yeah.
Slammin Sam. And quickly, I have new projects coming out on Instagram. Check it out, Lady Sage 97. New magazine features and work will be posted. And if you're interested in getting a signed magazine, hit me up.
Cool.
Slam and Sam, thank you for having me on the show. Lady Sage, good seeing you again, and the whole staff here.
Not the crew, the staff.
The crew. I'm sorry, the crew. And yeah, I want to give a shout out to my fiance Jennifer that's listening right now.
There you go.
And we're getting.
She's probably on the computer. Better to see.
And who's DJing the wedding?
Yeah.
Who's right here?
I don't know.
Right here.
So yeah, big shout out to my girl Jennifer. We're actually planning our wedding, so it's been kind of hectic just getting everything together. You know?
Awesome.
So it's in the works. So 2015 we'll be officially married.
Congratulations.
So, congrats, bro.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right.
Sam, thank you. Sage, thank you guys for bringing us here. I mean, like, we've been talking about this for so long. We canceled the first time. We apologize for that one because of Jason.
But that was your fault.
Yeah. And I mean, with schedules, but the crew, you guys are great, man. You guys, you know, totally rock. You know, we all got to bond in our good ways. Shout out to my wife, who's pregnant with our child. We're having a girl. Everybody knows that throughout the internet. Shout out to little baby Elena. Little DJ. Shout out to my boys Alvin and Mike. I know they're watching. They've been typing to Sam all this time. They're trying to probably get some drama to go on here. But thank you all the haters out there. You know who you are. Boosted my career. You can catch everything about me. DJChristylezLive.com has all my links to all my podcasts, all the social networks. I don't want to bust it all out. Mm-hmm. Clubstarters.net. Me and Jason got our whole thing going over there. The whole remix site, everybody knows about that. And our retail site will be dropping this week. So
awesome.
All the DJs, y'all need some gear.
Come or edits, some dope club hype stuff. Check out the site, clubstarters.net.
You'll see all our events. We'll be weekly. We're always fully booked weekly, so you can catch all our events there.
Awesome. Cool. I'll go ahead and close out the shouts and plugs. I'd like to thank my entire crew, Sage, Cindy, Mikey Mike.
We used to have a Mikey mic before. That would be strange.
Shh, don't say that.
I'm sorry.
It was supposed to
be. Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, no.
Broken heart. I don't like that Mikey monkey thing.
I'm the sloppy seconds.
Love.
Oh, don't say that.
We're going to stick with Mike on the mic.
Yeah, Mike on the mic. Yeah, that's the. I mean, even though there's a million Mike on the mics, and I try to get that patented, but it's so hard nowadays to do that. But
we're gonna stick with that for a while until
I think I'm the best one.
Yeah, there you go. Confidence. I like it.
There it is.
Joe Time, thank you very much for all your effort.
No doubt.
I'd like to thank my special guests, Club Starters, Jason D, Christylez.
Thanks,
you guys are the bomb. It's always good to have veteran leadership in the DJ world present on the studio.
Definitely.
That's all I got to say.
Oh, definitely.
Always.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank everyone that's in the chat room, that's interacting. Appreciate all the good stuff and all the funny stuff that I had to relay to everyone. And all the viewers out there that are watching from afar, continue to tune in every Monday night. Be sure to like our Facebook page as well as follow us on Twitter and Instagram. And this weekend, I'll be over in Walnut Creek for two dates, Friday night, Lift Lounge, and Hamachi Lounge in on Saturday. So it is Walnut Creek weekend for me. For more information, go to my Facebook page at I Am Slammin. All right, everyone, that does it for this episode of The Slam Show for myself and everyone here. Peace. We'll see you next week.
Peace.
Peace.